Hello, and welcome to yet another episode of Battle Rap Resume. And I know what you're thinking. Hang on, this isn't the voice I'm used to hearing, and you'd be right. I am not your regular host. Tom has ever so briefly handed the reins over to me today. And as we're going to discuss later, the quality of a battler is based on the opponent. And a podcast is only as good as its host, so we're in steadier hands than usual today. Who am I? I am Sam Wiles, pleased to meet you. And I'm very pleased to be hosting this absolutely incredible show today. I'm a podcaster in my own right. I host Paul or Nothing, a show where I review Paul McCartney albums, but I'll save my plug for later in the episode. That's not why I'm here today. I'm sure there'll be links in the description, yada yada yada. For the sake of full disclosure though, I am not a fan of battle rap. I'm a fan of Battle Rap Resume because I like quality long form content with interesting and creative people, and this show gives me that. But I am a long suffering friend of a guy who likes battle rap. That is who I am. But without further ado, let us introduce the man who made all of this happen. He is your regular host turned guest. It's Mr. Tom Kwei. How are you, my friend?
Hey, everyone. Hi. Thanks, Sam. Thanks so much for the introduction. And I should say, yeah, this is, first of all, this is an incredible egotistical thing for me to do on my own show. I must get that out the way straight away, before that gets commented. But I want to say that it's not something that I just thought of. It's something that I've copied. So maybe it's less kind of, you know, less kind of narcissistic in that sense. The Needle Drop, you know, Anthony Fantano.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure many of the listeners of the show. By the way, hello, everyone. Thanks so much for listening to this, the 50th episode of the show, which is a big milestone for me personally. And it was a big milestone for Anthony as well. I'm sure a lot of you know about Anthony Fantano and the Needle Drop. If you don't, search the guy on YouTube now. He's one of the greatest music critics of the modern era. Fantastic YouTuber, really funny, weird, interesting guy, so knowledgeable about so many things. Inspiration, genuine inspiration. And he does a podcast alongside his YouTube music videos where he has kind of just, it's not even necessarily music. He had Your Movie Sucks on recently, actually.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Oh fantastic.
So he kind of has big internet guys, you know, in that sort of sense, in any realm, music or otherwise. And for his 50th episode, he did exactly this. He got a close friend that he's known for a while outside of kind of the show or whatever on to interview him. So yeah, this is what we're doing, and you know, I couldn't have picked anyone better. But Sam, obviously me and Sam have been friends for like 6 or 7 years, is it, something like that?
Yes, and we've been talking bollocks ever since, really. But look, first of all, man, I've just got to say, without brown nosing you too much here, like, fucking congrats on the success of this show.
Thanks, man.
I was the doubting Thomas, and it's just gone from strength to strength. But you know, the plan today, obviously we're turning the format on its head. Obviously all of you out there have heard Tom interview a huge variety of rap battle artists from all walks of life, and we're going to delve into your story today. Now what you may not have known is that before Battle Rap Resume, when Tom was just a battlehead, obsessed with himself. He was a writer in his own right. But this wasn't your first podcast, was it?
No, it was not. I should get the plug out the way soon, and you know, I'll do it right now. Down in the Hole was my first podcast with yourself, Sam, actually.
Yes.
It's funny you bring that up. Yeah, me and Sam are both, as well as battle rap, I'm also, you know, hugely into music of all characters and forms, and one of my heroes, you know, been a hero for probably about, since we kind of discovered him together, didn't we, really? That being Tom Waits, the American singer-songwriter, in my eyes the greatest songwriter of all time. But I am biased, but like, because me and Sam have done a podcast called Down in the Hole. Search Tom Waits podcast on YouTube. Me and him tackled every album. Some of his albums from the 80s went like over 3 hours on, you know. And that's not us saying it braggadocious, like, it's deserving of that. The music's incredible, and like, it's very hard to sort of get across what Tom Waits is in a little soundbite. So I mean, what would you recommend?
The three episodes, the funny thing is, one of the things we talk about with Tom Waits is there are three albums to get you into it, but that's different for the three episodes to get you into the show. I'd either recommend One from the Heart, which is our first sort of long form professional episode. There was Swordfish Trombones, which is our most critically well received and most watched episode. We kind of like went hard on that one. Or Alice, the one where we just laughed the most, and it's easily the funniest episode just because of the sort of adult rated content. content that's on it.
I don't want to spend too long on weights, but I'll just say, yeah, in terms of music, if you're kind of just, maybe you want an album to listen to or whatever, and you're thinking of downloading something, I'd say listen to Alice, actually, by Tom Waits from 2002, based on the Lewis Carroll kind of Wonderland play, and just a terrifically dark,
very macabre, challenging.
Quite challenging, but quite melodic as well. Quite easy to listen to. And, I mean, beautiful, beautiful wintry album. But let's talk battle rap.
Yeah, look, okay.
Enough of that pretentious shit, man. Let's get into bars.
Like I say, you've been a writer as long as I've known you. And one day you came up to me and said you started watching things called rap battles. And this was about, what, I don't know, for about 2 years at this point. You quickly roped our good friend Danny into this debacle. Danny was on your top five don't flop battles episode. I absolutely love that. But it was kind of a very logical progression that you would give battling a shot, because one of the beauties of battle rap, and again, I look, we just gotta say, I'm looking at this from an outsider's perspective. I don't really know anyone involved in it, but that also gives me a kind of freedom to look at it a bit more objectively.
Yep.
But the beauty of it is, literally anyone with talent can rise to the top, or at least give it a shot. And that's what you did. You know, without getting into spoilers, I was planning on ripping you a new asshole today in a rather brutal fashion, in the style of a rather quasi Comedy Central roast. But I must admit, like, after rewatching your battles, I've become rather desensitized to it, and I have a lot to say in your favor. I mean, like, I'm biased as fuck here today. Right, let's get out of the way. I'm tribal. I don't give a shit.
But I must say, like, I made this point several times on the Tom Waits podcast, and people emailed in saying, you keep saying the same thing. And I was like, yeah, I know. But the Bon Jovi analogy, where, like, there was a shitty Bon Jovi album from the early 2000s, I think it was 2001, called Bounce. Terrible fucking album. Awful, like bland as hell, awful. My cousin gave it to me. When you have an iPod and you're young, you put whatever music you can get your hands on your MP3 player. And I would listen to it loads just because it was all I had, and I kind of like it. It's critically panned, rightfully so. And I think a sense of Stockholm syndrome has came over you here, Sam. Like, I'm not a good battler, but like you say, you are, you know, you are in a bubble to a certain extent, you know. I mean, How pervasive has battling been in our friendship circle as just a thing? You have had to watch a few battles just by virtue of being around me.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of substance abuse leads to rap battles being put on your TV. You are a big fan of YouTube on the TV.
Oh my god!
It is your future, as you say. I mean, I love Chilla Jones. I love Mark Grist. I love O'Shea, just because I love that kind of Scouse asshole.
Oh, he's O'Shea's the best, man.
I like watching your like compilation ones, like best Game of Thrones bars, best wrestling bars, because that's like very, very digestible for a guy like me who, like, I'm poor, but I have like very like weird conservative middle class sensibility. So I'm like scared of all these shouting guys in tracksuits. But I mean, I must admit, you found a few that I really did like. What's the famous Chilla Jones battle that is just five stars?
Oh, Chilla JC. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh my god. And and who's the big guy on King of the Dot? You know, brah, brah, brah.
Oh, Big Key.
Yeah, I love that guy.
Yeah, he's great.
I think I prefer the performers. But one thing that we are going to get into in this episode is that, look, I mean, we're all pretty intelligent guys here. I'm probably not going to be able to tell what the best bars in a battle are, but I think anyone who understands the English language can see a bad bar from a mile off. And that's one of the, I think that's one of the reasons why the crowds are always so critical at a rap battle. But then some of the best lines seem to go over a lot of people's heads. But you'll see one guy in the background just going, "Oh, damn," like that. And that's what we're going to get into today, you know. But we've known each other for ages. We did a podcast together. Are you going to feel a bit cringy about going over your old battles today?
Slightly. You know, I have been. I mean, the thing is, I put them on the channel because on the Battle Rise, my YouTube channel, quite early on, because I realised people would be curious, and it does come up on a lot of, like, when I've ever put the episodes on Reddit or whatever, on forums, people are like, oh, I remember on R&B the 8, it was like, which is kind of like a big rap battle forum thing, they were like, oh, who is this guy, you know, did he battle, who's Soliloquy, kind of, who's the mass man sort of thing. So I did want to put them out quickly, because, you know, if I was watching a podcast and that guy had done a battle, or he was in a band, and it, you know what I mean, but it wasn't his normal mode, I'd be like, what the fuck, I'd be like, I've got to check this out. So I thought, you know, I would want to see this, so other people want to see whatever, you know, sort of thing. But yeah, going through them, I don't know, it's weird. I think my best performance is actually my first battle. I mean, we'll get into that, but I think that's actually where I peaked, and then kind of the rest was kind of okay.
Some of the classic lines, because, I mean, being your friend, I have to put up with a lot of you just ringing me up with new bars that you've got. Danny talks
doesn't
about
really happen anymore.
Danny talks about this to no end. How, like, it'd be like 3 a.m. and he said, like, "Oh, Danny, how's this? I gave her anal with a nail," and like, and then he'd have to give you instant feedback. I know your girlfriend's been long suffering with it as well.
Oh yeah.
But battle rap wasn't your first public open forum expression of wordplay. Do you want to briefly tell us about yours, our days in the Birmingham spoken word scene?
Yeah. Well, I mean, as some people might have noticed, many people probably have not noticed this, but my personal Twitter handle is Tom Kwei Poet, because when I sort of debuted as a digital entity, it was poetry that I was really into. Both, you know, when I was kind of younger, massively into page poetry and reading poetry and the classic poets and mambas, whatever. You know, Norm McCaig was a personal favourite, Scottish existentialist, amazing poet. As I was reading to that side of it, and I was just reading to words, going through, you know, whatever, writing, doing short stories, poems, you know, everyone kind of has those affectations when they're like 18, keeping a journal, all that sort of stuff. And weirdly enough, it was kind of through battle rap how I started to get into spoken word as well, which was way before I even performed as a battler. So, long story short, it was like, you know, I was kind of just getting into battling, maybe my second year of university, and, you know, kind of really enjoyed it really quickly. And I remember I'd seen all the big battles, and I was sort of getting into the more of the, like, your souls and stuff like that, and you know, various people like Pamphlet was another one early on that I really connected to. And I remember I went on holiday, like, it was kind of like second year ended, and we went on a family holiday to Turkey or whatever, and it's one of those holidays where you just sort of sit around and whatever, and just kind of, you know, listen to music or write or read books by the pool, or, you know, it's not really that active. I took like a big A4 pad with me, and I remember I just couldn't stop writing bars. Like, I don't know what happened. Like, I've been watching battling for like 3 or 4 months and not written a bar. Like I'd thought of a few bars. I remember my friend Dave that I lived with, we were walking to this bar once, and I was just like, I was telling him about bars that I've written, and I can remember being nervous because it was the first time I'd ever said, like, oh, I've actually written some stuff. And I was like, oh, they were awful. I was like, he was like, learn it, fam, I'm from Birmingham. I was just like, it was just kind of these inklings of rhymes and, you know, whatever, you don't really know what you're going on. But yeah, anyway, so I go to Turkey, and I just remember that was all I did. That was literally all I did, was just write in this A4 pad, and bars just coming out constantly, wordplay schemes. None of it was that good, of course, I strain to mention, but a lot of it did make the first battle, and I'll kind of point out a lot of those bars when we get to the sort of thing. But, you know, writing a fuck ton of bars. And I remember I was my brother lives in Australia now, but that was when my brother was, you know, a little while ago, so my brother still lived with us. And he was long suffering. I remember every afternoon I'd sort of throw bars at him that I'd written that day. And the first day he enjoyed it, so I kind of got the false impression that he wanted me to do it more. But then later on he was just like, I don't give a fuck, man. I don't understand a lot of these, and they're not very good. And like, he was my only audience. So, you know, and then I remember as well, like, at the end of the holiday, after like 7 days, had like a few pages left of the fucking thing. There's so many, but they were written in big handwriting, I should say. It wasn't on the lines sort of thing, you know. And I have terrible handwriting as well, so it's kind of giant, spidery, awful. But I remember I kind of, like, I thought I'll make a round, and I kind of started to put bars into order, and that's where it gets you. That's where it becomes real, I think. When you perform it to yourself, and you put your iPhone and you record it, and you're like, oh shit, this is 60 seconds. I've got a 60-second round that I could sort of, if I learn this, you know, the learning is the next step as well, and that definitely gets you into it. But it was that early stuff. So that's when I got into kind of like writing bars and stuff. But I'm not really sure what happened for the rest of third year. I mean, I battled Danny, didn't I, as well? I completely forgot about that, but that was actually my first battle. Yeah, but this is weird.
That was someone's, it was in someone's back garden, wasn't it?
Oh, no, that's right. Okay. Yeah, you're bringing back so many memories now. Okay, so sorry, we'll get to the spoken word thing. So yeah, I've seen battles, you know, in 2012, went on holiday, and it really was. I mean, it's kind of weird. I haven't really even verbalized this turkey writing session. I mean, like the bars are in my old house as well. Like, obviously, I live in Oxford now, but back in Birmingham, I'm pretty sure the bars are. I have like stacks of things that just don't get touched. You know what I mean? So I reckon they are there. I'll have to find some of them, put them online. Maybe I'll go through them for a video or something. That would be quite funny, or whatever.
Oh, that would be funny.
That would be funny, actually. That would be good. That'd be good content. But so yeah, in the summer of 2012, we were at Jordan Tallis's house.
Was that Jordan Tallis's party?
Who's a good mutual friend of ours. His nickname's Rice. I won't explain why. It's not very interesting, but it's a good nickname. That's stuck for some
reason. Was that the party where I sucker punched him?
No, that was my house party, like 2 years before. Yeah, so... So this was Jordan Tallis's party. I was there with Danny O'Gorman. Danny O'Gorman, as you say, is kind of like, you know, one of our closest friends, a really old friend of yours, really good friend of mine as well. He's been on Battle Resume. He did the Battle Resume logo, as I said. You know, he's a great co-host, so knowledgeable about Battle Rap. His knowledge of verses is insane.
Yeah,
you can literally, he can recite the entirety of Chilla JC. He can literally do it word for word, and he'll fuck off maybe a word or two, but he'll know it. He'll know like 98%. It's crazy, this guy, you know, obviously going to have him on the show war. But I was writing bars. He was writing bars. You know, we were both getting into battle rap a lot. We were both really drunk, and it was just kind of like, oh, let's just do a battle. Fuck it. We'll do a battle in the garden. Like, obviously a lot of our friends from school or whatever were there. And we remember we got a small crowd and we did it. And I think we did like two rounds each, and like, it was pretty ramshackle, but you know, it's kind of like the primordial man, you know, when you're rubbing the sticks together and finally you get a spark. Like, if you get reaction to a bar, like, that is ecstasy. And, you know, that was the first one. So, yeah, we battled there. And then when I went into third year, I was part of the Bernardo Society at university.
Yes.
Which is very lame. But it was just kind of one of those things you put on your CD wear. And it was all right. You know, we did a lot of cool events, actually. We did organise quite a lot of things, including a rap battle. So we did like a sort of charity night where we had bands and like shit like that. And this is in Liverpool. This is in Hannah's Bar, if anyone remembers Hannah's Bar. And we went there. And we, me and Danny, this is when I was known as Klandestine. Danny was known as Controversy. He's still known as Controversy. He's still never battled Danny. He's one of those guys you can sort of lead a horse to water sort of thing. Like, I've been trying to get into battle for so long. Because he is a really intelligent writer, and his schemes
same
that he has.
Podcasting, man, same with podcasting. I'd love him to do a show, but
yeah, so we did the battle, you know, at the bar, and I remember it went okay. There is actually footage of it that I've still got, I think, on an old laptop or something, but it went all right. I remember Danny really mumbled a lot, and like, I had a lot of bars about Jimmy Savile because that had just happened, and there was some reaction. And I remember there was quite a funny moment after, because it kind of went down okay. It wasn't a horrible, there was quite a lot of people there. There was probably like 50 people there. If anyone knows the kind of function room in Hannah's Bar, there's kind of like a big bar there, and, you know, band area and stuff, and a mixing desk, so, you know, it's fairly large. But I remember afterwards, because obviously when you go to university every year, you're in new seminars with people in your kind of, you know, whatever, your class. So there's new faces you see, old faces you see sort of thing. And by chance, this girl that I hadn't seen for like a year was there. And she was like, oh, how you doing? I was like, hey. She was like, were you just rap battling? And I was like, yeah. And like, you know, she'd last seen me on some fucking Yates seminar or some shit. You know, I didn't really know her. Like, so yeah, anyway, that was, you know, kind of doing that. And like, I think for the rest of third year, I'd like to say I was like working. I wasn't really like studying, but whatever, you know. I don't know. I was trying to get into Don't Flop into some capacity. I was really interested in doing it, but nothing really kind of, you know, came about, to be honest with you. Nothing kind of went to fruition. It was really difficult that way. So then at Anglican Cathedral in Liverpool, you know, absolutely amazing cathedral is. I think we visited before, Sam. You know, beautiful, beautiful building. You know,
the dwarven fortress.
Yes.
Yeah. It's massive.
It's unbelievable. So I was there. Yeah, I was there with someone, and we were just kind of looking around inside the church. And there was a poster for an upcoming night that was to do with Lipper, because in Liverpool they have Lipper, which is like that Paul McCartney music school, art school. That's like really, you know, kind of like a Brit school sort of thing. So anyway, it was like this thing for this concert. It was two music artists, and they were like from Don't Flop, Harry Baker who I don't know if you're aware of, but I'm sure everyone listening will be aware of. Had him on the show.
He's big at the fringe, isn't he?
Yeah, massive spoken word guy, incredible. You know, I think he won like the European Slam, like, you know, majorly talented guy, awesome guy. And I was like, oh fuck, I'm so gonna go to this. Like, I was just like, yeah, you know, I'd seen one or two of his battles. I think one was out at the time, but I was like, oh, I like this guy, spoken word guy sort of thing. And I went there and I watched it, and he was fantastic, and I was really spellbound by it. I thought, you know, it was a real sort of transcendental moment when I was experiencing kind of poetry and battling as one kind of thing. These two passions are kind of coalescing to this guy. And I remember I left and it was raining really heavy, but I lived in the centre of Liverpool, so it wasn't that far. So I kind of ran 10 minutes and I think I grabbed some beers as well for some reason. And then I went home and I went to my desk and I wrote I Want You to Be My Ex, like in one sitting. Like
that poem, oh my God.
Which is, because yeah, to get long story short, so get into the spoken word now, yeah. So I used to do spoken word quite a bit. I don't really do it anymore, but you know, search me on Tom Kwei spoken word on YouTube and you'll find loads of videos on there and stuff. It's very pun based as well. I think battle rap fans will enjoy it. It's very scheme based. But yeah, the first thing that I wrote was I Want You to Be My Ex, which is about kind of me getting on better with my girlfriends after we've broken up. And similar to the Turkey session, it just sort of came out and I was just like, ah, oh, and I was just, and then I think I performed a little bit in Liverpool. There were a few nights on at like the Egg Cafe and the Dead Good Poets Society, I think they were called as well. There were a few other things. You know, Liverpool's quite good for the art scene as well. The Windows Project I worked with as well. Dave Ward, great local poet. That was kind of his poetry charity that I did a little stuff with as well. And yeah, I was just, I kind of forgot battle rap for a bit then. I was still a fan, but it was more like I could actually do spoken word gigs, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I couldn't get a battle, so I just kind of, whatever I could get active within is what I was attracted to.
Yeah, and then obviously that Birmingham has quite an active scene. Yeah. You came back, uni had finished. I was quite local still. Went to quite a few nights, it was quite funny. And then that spawned our first kind of collaborative offspring, didn't it, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you remember what they said, Tom?
I do actually. I'm very proud of that, yeah. And I'm glad that we're getting a chance to talk about it on here, because I think anyone listening should to check it out if it sounds like something they're interested in. So, yeah, me and Sam went to a hell of a lot, like after Liverpool, I moved to Manchester, and that was like the year where I was just spoken word crazy.
There was the beta version of it, wasn't there?
Yeah. That's where it started. Yeah, so I went to loads of spoken word nights. I was performing loads. You know, I was writing a hell of a ton, and again trying to get into battling in some way, but still couldn't seem to, you know, get forward in that sense. Or I think I might have actually done the Nader battle before Manchester, but that didn't seem to be coming out for months, kind of thing. So it was just kind of,
yeah,
I was doing this thing. Anyway, I went to enough spoken word nights and I was enough of a fan of kind of HBO and, you know, kind of long form drama content and loved all that sort of shit, that I started thinking like this would be good for a TV show in some way, like a spoken word drama, like something set in a poetry night. But to make it interesting, we wouldn't do it like, it would be kind of it'd be like a closed set, so everything would take place at this night, so it'd only be like kind of 8 p.m. on a Wednesday in this world, and then episode 2 would be the next week, you know what I'm saying, sort of thing. But I thought it'd be more interesting if we took away conventional dialogue and did it through poems, so all the characters were poets and we just saw their poems, and we kind of had to learn where the story was going, if things were inferred from poetry, and some of the characters would just do standalone poetry. You might have like the political poet or the, you know, the feminist poet or the poet going on about bottled water in the second episode or whatever. Or you might have, you know, story poets as well. Like, we might have two characters at the end of episode 1. There'd be a little bit of dialogue here and there. You know, they're going to go out for a date, and then, you know, in the second episode, their poems maybe reflect that. And it is contrived to a certain extent, but it was a fun experiment in writing. And, you know, I wrote with a good friend of mine, Adam Goodyear, me and him created the characters and wrote the scripts. We did the sort of beta pilot. So we shot something in Manchester and then we shot 2 episodes in Birmingham. They're online, man. You directed it. I'm proud of it. It was good.
It was very fun, man. We had a great cast who then dispersed to the four corners of the globe, literally. And obviously, it's something that we will probably have to take a stab at again someday. Yeah. But yeah, that's kind of the lead up to everything. Obviously, you've been into rap for ages. Were any of your favourite artists an influence on you in your early days of writing at all?
Yeah, I think the biggest influence on me was Jest. who is my favorite rapper of all time. I actually started a series on the channel early on called Gesticulations, where I'm reviewing all of his releases. Haven't done an episode for like 5 months now or something. I really need to get around to that. I've been trying to do when I'm falling down. But yeah, if anyone's aware of Jest, incredible. Just there's no influence of Jest in the sense of kind of like you would listen to me, you would ever think I sound anything like Jest. Like I can barely string a multi together. Like technically, I'm pathetic compared to Jest. But it was just kind of his creative flair that really spurred me on. I was really inspired by a lot of his albums, a lot of the depth of reference as well, and really kind of witty puns and wordplay that I really like, that kind of cheeky, clever stuff. But that, yeah, that was it really. And then, you know, during the kind of, there was that kind of spoken word phase thinking. And then eventually I think I moved back to Birmingham, and then just, I kind of was done with spoken word really, and needed something new. And, you know, battling was an interesting jumping point.
Yeah, so shall we just dive right into the first bond? And I think
we should.
This is your battle with Nader.
Yeah.
Because I'm getting personal with this gargoyle. I'll break into your house and replace your Listerine with my pissing stream and wait to hear you gargle. Because I make music, you just make me sick. I mean, your beats, dude, are about as tacky as beetroot, and your shit on tracks like train loops.
So this was released on the 25th of November 2013. How fucking time has flown, eh? Wow. Like, oh, you look so young.
I know.
You were called Klandestine in this one. Where did that name come from, and why did you ultimately drop it?
I mean, obviously I dropped it because of the racial connotation. But I didn't intend, but it shows such a lack of foresight on my part that it's very embarrassing. But yeah.
Dude, you're so smart. You're so intelligent. And it's such an obvious thing. Like, yeah. I think literally everyone picked up on it straight away, but yeah, it's so funny.
Yeah. It's one of those things where you're so close that you don't realize. But yeah, Klandestine, it started from, I had this book when I was younger that was just kind of like, expand your vocabulary, interesting old words. And I remember one of the words was Klandestine with a C. Used to describe like espionage and secret agents, and it basically, if he's like a clandestine man, he's kind of like, you know, submerged and, you know, enigmatic. So I always liked that, and I kind of, that word always stuck with me, and I always just kind of liked that word. And then when it came time to kind of putting something together,
wasn't this around the time that Martin Scorsese's Hugo had come out as well?
That was after. But
was it? Okay, because yeah. I know that word is used by Chloe Grace Moretz's character, and you went mad for that.
Yeah. It's a word you notice here and there. It's definitely quite an expostulatory word. You know what I mean? Kind of, it's quite a clandestine. Like, it's kind of battlery in a sense as well. And so I just thought early on, yeah, Klandestine, and it just kind of, weirdly, I'd always had Soliloquy in the back of my head. I was always wrestling with a couple of names, and Soliloquy was definitely one of them.
Well, see, what people might not know is that our little friendship group, our circle, has about 8 to 10 pun-based games that we always play. Me and Danny, for your birthday a couple of years ago, gave you a book of puns that we'd done at work together.
Amazing.
And one of the things that is a mainstay of the group is how that your surname, Kwei, is the easiest name to add puns to ever. Mm-hmm. And you could do anything you want with it. Mm-hmm. And like, Soliloquy just fits so perfectly. But obviously, like, this is your first on-camera battle. We've discussed that you had some off-camera experience with Danny. You've done spoken word stuff. Were you nervous at all about this battle?
Yes, I was. I should say quickly how this battle sort of came about, because obviously I'm in spit roast battles, which is this kind of like minor Birmingham league. Because basically what happened was I was kind of getting frustrated that I wasn't getting onto Don't Flop, because anyone who's tried to get onto Don't Flop, you know, you email the entry at Don't Flop, whatever, you wait, you email, you wait, and you know, never get any response. Like, I remember we had Matt Sherry on quite a while ago, and he was saying you got a response immediately, and that's kind of how spurred him on. And I guess it does happen to some people, but for whatever reason, it wasn't coming through for me. So I just started looking more local. Like, I was aware of Barmageddon, which is a Wolverhampton league, but they weren't active at the time. So I just thought, are there any Birmingham leagues? And did a little bit of searching, found them, emailed them, or Facebook messaged them, or whatever. The guy eventually got back to me. And I remember it'd been like literally a month, and then kind of like, you know, you get a little message in or whatever, and you're like, oh fuck yeah, I forgot I even fucking sent this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And he was like, oh yeah, you're battling this guy called Nader in like, you know, a month or so, is that cool? And I'm like, yeah. I can't remember exactly what happened from there, but it definitely was quite nerve-wracking. Just the sense kind of like, how people are going to respond to the writing more than anything, because like I felt quite confident in front of a crowd. I had done the spoken word before, and this was fairly kind of entry level as well. There wasn't too much pressure on the line, you know what I mean? It wasn't too bad, but I mean, there's always going to be a certain nervousness. And I remember getting there, I went with Ryan, one of our friends, and the actual venue is in a very northern part of Digbeth, where it's mostly factories, and it was just kind of...
Oh, it's Digbeth?
Yeah, it's in Digbeth, yeah, which is just kind of Birmingham's kind of little clubby area, and... the factories kind of devolved into these rooms, and you know, they were just kind of like blaring hip-hop. I remember it was so loud, and there were huge crowds gathered outside. And what's that, huge crowds gathered outside? It's quite a small alleyway, so it seemed huge. When you got into the actual room, it was you know, it's probably about 20 people there or something like that. And I remember going in, and you know, I think we were quite not late, but I think, you know, kind of the door's been open for about an hour or so, and the first thing I saw was Nader. Nader like ran up to me, and Nader, as we're going to see, is kind of like, you know, completely fucked in this battle, off his head, and he ran up to me, like put his arms with me, like, mate, where have you been, sort of thing. And I was just like, what? It's like 9, yeah. Like he said 8, like none of the battles have started or whatever. He goes, oh, I thought you cancelled. And I was like, nah. I was like, we've been talking for like, I think it was like 2 months we had for the battle or something like that. It was quite a long time. Mm-hmm. So we've been talking for a good while. So obviously knew I was coming. I said I was coming, you know, just before or something like that. So that was a bit of a weird air. But yeah, actually sort of stepping into the pit, it wasn't too bad. And I don't think I came out too bad in this one either.
Yeah. Well, I mean, again, luckily, I'm only a guest. I'm not affiliated with this show in any legal sense. I don't know anyone in battle rap. So I'm looking at, I can say this, but like this Nader, like he's a bit of an odd one from like the word go, isn't he? I mean, like he goes fucking mad when you say that you're from Sutton, and then he's like, "Yo, Sutton, London, or Sutton Coldfield."
Yeah.
And then like you answer politely that like, you know, you're from Sutton Coldfield, which is an area, but he's like, don't say Sutton, man, because like, obviously there's like some sort of Sutton in London.
Yeah.
And like he's just the epitome of what I would fear from being a battle rap fan, kind of this loudmouth laddish tweaker type. But so for your first three battles, you get to go first.
Okay.
So you open with a line that, you know, as debut lines go, and I've watched quite a few sort of intro battles, a few tryouts in prep for this show, so I had at least a bit of semblance of knowing what I'm talking about. You say, "Yo, Nader, there's a difference between you and me. I'm a lover, you're a fighter. So while you're out there trying to be a wannabe G, I'm there in your mom's bed sleeping where your dad should be." And which already gets an immediate sort of reaction from the audience. Did you feel like you had started off strong?
I felt that was a strong starter. I mean, I don't know why I wrote with this kind of quasi mom jizz.
We're going to get into that. You are orally sort of liquidy fixated in this.
It's like if you compare my two Don't Flop battles to this, then yeah, it is embarrassing for me to look back. But this is the sort of stuff that you write early on, and I'm sure a lot of people play testament to that. And maybe it was a little later on than 2009, so I should have sort of grown out of it. But I was still new into battling. But yeah, no, I knew that line was going to hit. It's kind of like a little flip on the mom dad joke with a kind of inference of, you know, paternal authority as well.
Because we've mentioned in other walks of life when talk about music, movies and stuff, that indifference is worse than a negative reaction. And like you show me some tryouts like where there's been just like dead silence. So I mean, to get something from the crowd at this first juncture, like you must have felt good.
The crowd were good though, like from what I recall. I remember I watched a couple of the other battles there and they were pretty decent. There was this one kid, I forget his name now, but he was really like, he was kind of like almost a blizzard, like he just kind of, you know, his cap on, he was like 16 or something, he was killing it, he was great. I have to remember what that guy's name is, but the crowd were good, and I think the crowd were just grateful there were fucking battles in the Midlands, which they never ever are. So Birmingham especially, I don't think Don't Flop been to Birmingham for like 4 years, so I mean, I think they're coming back next year. But yeah, the crowd, you know, crowd were okay, and it was good to get a reaction. I mean, I was just kind of looking at him, I wasn't kind of thinking too much about the camera, the lens right by my ear. You know,
like I know you would like I know you you practiced quite religiously, not like a Rain Man-esque length, but like you did practice a lot. And even if you had a good or bad reaction from the crowd, like, it must be quite easy to choke. Is it hard to, like, remain composed even after, like, a good crowd reaction? Is it hard to not kind of, like, get lost in your own kind of pride at that moment and carry on?
Yeah, I mean, very, very difficult. The most chokes you see in battles seem to occur after huge, huge reactions, and that just makes sense, because it kind of, your entire train of thought is derailed. So, I mean, after my first bar, it wasn't like you know, anyone who knows Ty Law Snow, I know you won't be aware of that battle. Danny loves that battle. That has two back-to-back haymakers, some of the biggest reactions. It's not on that Ty Law Snow level. But,
well, you do have a follow-up line, which is the first kind of big laugh of the battle, which is, the recession hit your family hard, but my erection hit her harder. And then you get right up in his face for this. I got to jizz in her eye for a pound of time and demanded change from that fiver. And, like, I love how you get up in his face, King of the Dot style, like, on your debut. Like, did you think prior to this battle, like, about your body language and your physical persona much?
No, I didn't. And, you know, I'm not, you know, I'm fairly tall, kind of, you know, I don't know, you know, bigger set guy, I should say. But, like, I don't sort of own that in the ring, I don't think. And I think this was probably my most confident and bolshy. Like, yeah, I do really start barking at him to a certain extent. And he kind of nudges back a little bit. And it gets you know, a little bit of a close call there. But it wasn't fueled by any dislike for Nader. It was just kind of... I mean, ask anyone who battles, the rhythms of your body are often compelled by something beyond what you've planned. Like, you just, the bar just feels some certain way. And again, you know, I wanted to sort of tie in the recession idea there, that I myself still need to conserve money, and it's quite cheek. So, but it was still a line that I'm, you know, not proud of.
Yeah, well, you know, we've got lines that are like blood streaming like Netflix. I'll take your bitch and put her lips to my six. By the time I'm done, she's looked like she's licked a bowl of cake mix. That goes down very, very well. But that one took a moment to land. Mm-hmm. And I think that's because it's a very, like, specific image that the human brain can't quite instantly conjure. And, like, you look incredibly pleased with yourself at that moment. And then there's, like, this gormless-looking chap in the background who looks very happy as well. Mm-hmm. And I love the way you say cake mix, like, again, for clarification, like, you're questioning yourself on whether it was lame or funny. And, like, you're almost questioning the entire meta of battle rap just in two words. It really, like, kind of made me giggle.
Just one thing. Just, I think sometimes with punches as well, you know, it is the image, but it's also just, like, the diction, words you don't often hear in battles. Cake mix is one of them. Like, it's just something that doesn't, you know, that isn't that concurrent.
Then we go on to one of your less kind of focused areas, and it's, like, annoyingly not as strong as what you open with. We're right back onto, like, fixation with bodily fluids and the forced consumption of them. We don't need to get too Freudian on that level. I don't like
so much jizz in this opening battle.
And it's thick as cake mix as well. But, like, I don't like the rhyming of gargle with gargle. And then you have this wonderfully trite line that, like, really annoyed me, which is, I make music, you just make me sick. It's absolutely terrible.
Yeah, it's awful.
Like,
but don't, what, pissing stream Listerine's not bad.
that kind of made me giggle, just because, again, you don't hear Listerine a lot.
You don't?
It's very white bread rap at this point. But I make music, you just make music. It's obviously like a precursor to another line, which has a similar structure later at the end of the round, which works infinitely better. But with this one, I'm not sure what came first, the lame concept or the lamer rhyme. I mean, then you do the same thing in a second when you say, like, you know, your imagination sounds like it's gone through a castration. But then it picks up a little. And I love this one. And, like, you kind of, you have this thing where you start off strong, you sag in the middle, and then you pick it up again. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like the things that people remember are the start and the end. And I think you take advantage of that. And then you spit like you have brain damage, but I could spit in Latin sign language and still manage a savage advantage. It's clan, bitch. And And I remember thinking, damn, when I first saw that. Like
savage advantage. Ugh.
Savage advantage, it's clan bitch. Like, I talk about on my Paul McCartney podcast a lot that, like, you can tell what Paul's going to rhyme things with. Like, he says mellow, you know he's going to say fellow or yellow just because he writes in kind of very obvious ways.
Right.
I never thought you could rhyme clan bitch with advantage or savage, and it worked very well.
Mm-hmm.
And it caught me off guard with how complicated it was, but the way you end it is one of my favorite bars you've ever done. And I remember you spoke to me about this in a certain park once. It was just, I embody wordplay, you embody the word gay, and it's so simple and juvenile. Yeah. And ridiculous, but it's the way you go and you embody the word gay, like that, like you don't even like shout it at him.
Yeah.
it kind of falls out your mouth. I love that. So yeah, you know, you come out the round, you come out pretty hot. You have like this kind of charisma and white guy charm. Not, you know, you had the kind of like the aggression and intimidate factor early on, but you don't really like use that much in your later days. It's kind of hard to lose that lower middle class swag. But you know, you pick up the momentum and you finish on a high. Then we get to Nader's round. And just before I lay into this guy, what did you think about him? Like, had you heard of him before? Did you know his style? Like, I don't think you were in that phase in your quote-unquote career yet where you'd done research on people before the battle. Like, did you know much about Nader?
Yeah, there was a few videos around. There was one like really badly shot. It looked like it was shot on like really old camcorder, but it was from like 2014 or some shit. And of him like walking down a kind of alleyway and talking about his life and shit. And it was really like melodramatic and boring. So I didn't really fear him. There wasn't any footage of him battling. I don't know. I think this was his tryout actually. And I think he had came down from London or whatever. But like 2 weeks before, there was a video that he uploaded and tagged me in of him just like doing a grime freestyle about me, like pissed off his head and on his bed and his webcams like on him and shit. It's awful.
Oh my god.
So bad. And it wasn't really even about me because obviously he didn't really know anything about me, so just kind of using Klandestine and whatever. But yeah, I didn't really know too much, and like, you know, it's all about first impressions, isn't you? When he kind of ran up to me pissed when I first got into the venue, I was kind of like, okay, this guy.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, like you say, he is his opening gambit is incredible.
Yeah, I mean, like, as an outsider, I feel like he's a much bigger name than he is, probably just because I've heard you and Danny talk about Nader so much. Like in my head, I think I've heard his name more than Urs. That's all I'm saying.
Wow.
But Nader. Like, definitely, man. Like I think Nader's the third most popular battle rap artist in the country.
Let's just clarify, he's a no name nothing, all right?
So he comes out literally screaming like a retired banshee, and like I think like he's seen like one or two of O'Shea's battles and thought that it was the loudness that won him the rounds, not the impressive wordplay.
Mm-hmm.
And it just comes across as like fucking unbearable to listen to. Like, fuck this guy, Klandestine. Your mum is a slag. Yeah. And a transvestite. And like, he's obviously brought a crew with him who go absolutely mad at this half rhyme bullshit that like we could have written back in junior school. But like, it gets better because like you see a crack in the armor and like a crack in his voice as he's clearly spent so much of his brain power shouting that he has to drop his hyper aggressive persona in order to remember this line. This bad man's walking around saying, yeah, I'm Klandestine, you ain't gonna stab me with a knife, I'll get you beat up. What? And then it's like, Klandestine, he could use a C, but he's a racist type. He's a racist guy.
Yeah.
And he has this terrible crutch of having to say fuck it every 5 seconds. And like he's got like shitty rapper Tourette syndrome. Like, he's really barking no bite. And like I can barely watch it in one sitting. And like you could probably say to me, Sam, you know, he's probably attempting more of a freestyle thing than you were, but he really doesn't deliver the goods. Like, there's this one bit where he's like, this guy looks like a prick. And then like, he smiles and the crowd laughs. But it's one of those moments when, you know, as a kid who was like a loser back in junior school, I know when people are laughing at you and laughing with you. And it really, this is when it starts to blur. And you know, like, I mean, you've come out with an attempt. I'm not going to like fully endorse that, say you did it successfully, but you come out with an attempt at some genuine lyricism, some flow and some pacing setups, payoff, yada, yada, yada. And then you have to sit through this torrent of tat on the other end. And then he calls you a prick again and then ends his round with, next, whatever. Like, he just runs out of steam, like Thomas the Tank Engine.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, did you feel confident at this point? Did you feel like you were going to win it? Or did you think that, you know, this is kind of still early days and it could go either way?
Yeah, I wasn't really analysing the situation. I was just readying the second. And I think, actually, I couldn't remember the second or the third. I do remember, like, checking my phone just quickly to remind myself of the bars and picking from each round, which you really shouldn't do. But the occasion got up to me, I think, as it does a lot of people, and I sort of struggled to recall. So I wasn't really thinking too much about Nader at this point. I just wanted to leap into the second.
Yeah, so you start off with some pre-standard clandestine bars. I'm a traditional guy. I love a story with a moral. I love it when your girl gives me oral.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to come across as insulting. I want to physically wound you and rub the salt in. I do like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, I feel like we're back on track a little bit. Mm-hmm. And then there's your first choke at the end of your first second round. Like, how did that feel?
Bad, shitty. Yeah, chokes never feel good. Embarrassing. You know, you think of all I could think of when I was choking was all the hours I'd spent in the garden pacing up and down, learning this shit. And I was just like, why is this happening? This shouldn't be happening. So yeah, and then I think that is when I actually forgot. I repressed the fact that I fucking choked. But yeah, that's when I started to pick from the different rounds. I think that's when I kind of closed with my what was in my third in the second.
Okay, just for this whole episode, I'm really going to go into your first rounds and kind of blur the second and third. This MC is just at square, like the general theory of relativity. I love that. Mm-hmm. Apparently, like, that bar was so good, even like a hungry panda in the audience off camera groaned with like respect for it. It was kind of like, and do you feel like you were constructing whole tapestries at this point, or was it a bit more like the Beatles, where you're taking odds and ends from different things, like nice lines, funny skis, and just kind of stitching them together and hoping?
Just lines, yeah. I mean, really, if you were to look at this on paper, you could see, you know, where the bullet points start and stop. Like, yeah. You know, it is that sort of thing. I don't think. Some, you know, I think I like my Aloha bar. I think that's probably my favorite bar of that battle, actually. But about that,
I'm getting the most last, and I'm not even trying. You're spitting your best stuff and getting Aloha like you're Hawaiian. Yeah. Love it.
Yeah.
I'm a DIY kind of guy. So last night I hammered your girl, gave her angle with a nail.
Yeah.
She took that as a courtesy because she only gave it gets touched up by the blind, like Braille. Love that. One line that did catch me off guard as well was, I'm getting the applause easy. You just look like you have cerebral palsy.
No, and then someone says, he does though. And I'm like, yeah, he does.
Then one last line from Nader, because like, I feel bad giving him this much airtime, but he says, you're probably taking heroin. You're skinny like a pelican. You probably fuck your mother in the stomach, because when she gave birth to you, it was a cesarean. And I'm just like, I said that to my girlfriend. Yes, I just like I was just like, you know, what do you think of this? Because like, she teaches English, she teaches poetry, and we just agreed that he has no flow or connective tissue between anything he's saying. It's literally just wacky insult after wacky insult. And I don't know, like, you could argue to be blue in the face that this could just be his kind of persona, but it's just like generic. I think that you know, despite the kind of like the rough, laddish personas that you get in battle rap, it's very intellectual stuff. It's really well crafted. And this is just anti-intellectual, alpha puppy bollocks, really. And he tries to make up for it with like a violent persona. But like, can we just briefly discuss the last line before we wrap up your first battle? What the fuck is, I have that Boris Johnson bojo flow.
this was 2013, so this was definitely a time in, you know, sort of popular culture opinion, Boris Johnson was viewed a little bit more harmlessly rather than the kind of, you know, Brexiteer coward that he is now. So we had this, you know, yeah, I just, the intelligent but didn't seem it. I was just thinking of that idea and I was like, oh, Boris Johnson's intelligent but doesn't really seem it. So I just tied it together.
Yeah, so like, you won this, right? Like, the video doesn't exactly make it clear at all who won, but I mean,
there were no judging.
Yeah,
the battle just kind of ended, and then me and Nader just kind of chatted briefly about something or other. I can't remember. I remember him saying, actually, he was making excuses, and he was like, oh, I didn't think you were going to come, all this sort of stuff. I didn't know it was confirmed. And he was like, mate, you made a blog about me 2 weeks ago. Like, I don't, like, what where's the evidence? You know, you're just coming up with these kind of, these stupid excuses that just...
Basically, he's gotten pissed, and he's fucked up.
Yeah.
Because, like, but the comments on the video, like, and, you know, the crowd in the video are clearly on your side. So, you know, did you feel good after this first battle? Did you feel like you'd learned some lessons after this kind of baptism of fire?
I felt good. I felt it went well. I was disappointed about the choke, but I felt the reaction was good. And I felt if someone was going to watch it, they would enjoy it. And I did show it to friends afterwards, and they did enjoy it, and they were quite, you know, I'm not going to say they're impressed, because obviously it's not like technically impressive, but, you know, I think I didn't do bad for myself. I do remember, actually, after the, because it was in this kind of sort of bar club sort of thing, and after the battle there were some more battles on, and I went over to get a drink, and the like, sort of, there wasn't like a bar, it was just almost like a sort of hole in the door, and there's just this big like dude there, this big guy, and he was like, yo man, I like your battle. And I was like, oh cheers. And he's just like, oh yeah, you got to get your timing better. And he talked to me about the timing of punching. I can't remember what the fuck he said. I remember he talked to me for so long, and I was like, yeah, and I just wasn't really even listening or whatever. But I remember he was the first guy that, like, he mentioned a few bars, is what I'm saying, and that, you know, he enjoyed them, and that's a really cool thing. I'm sure any battler will say that you just want people to enjoy this shit, because obviously yeah. you enjoy writing it, so you want there to be a transference of energy to the audience, which sounds really meta and weird, but you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. Like, you want people to vibe with it. And afterwards, yeah, I enjoyed the battle, went really well, but I think that battle was filmed like maybe late August, and then in that sort of August September time, that's when I moved to Manchester and sort of became spoken word heavy. And like you said, I think it was like for quite a while that it didn't come out, and I do remember it coming out or getting a message when I was on the bus home, and like using my data to like stream it, because I couldn't wait to watch it, like
especially in those days, probably would have gone through your whole contract at that point. On to your next battle. This is your Murta battle.
We were meant to battle on Words Are Weapons, so if words are weapons, then mine are sharper, because my mind is harder than a samurai's katana. Saying yes to this battle clearly classes you as a self-harmer, because it's a knife fight. Killer syllables digging deep and leaving the mark. The past two rounds showed you ain't got a handle on this cutting edge, just taking stabs in the dark, and a man in this room flakier, you could not look rapier. I'm forever putting words together, the saviour out, witting every victim on my way to success. This ain't wordplay, it's swordplay. I just added an S. This man is a mess.
I'm pretty sure that this was the first battle of yours I actually sat down to watch in full. Like, I'd heard all about Nate, but I think like something or other happened and kind of passed me by.
Right.
This was the first time I saw you doing your thing, as it were. So this was quite a long time after your first battle then?
Yes, this was quite a while. A long time actually, because I lived in Manchester for a year and then I moved back to Birmingham for a year. And this was around that era where what happened was I was in Manchester, and at the time I was going to a lot of Words of Weapons events, which I know you probably won't be aware of, but like a grime league headed up by this guy called Chronicle, and it was all on beat, and you know, they had a pretty fucking good roster, to be fair. They, you know, they still got some classic battles on there. Really, really good league. Big fan of the league. And they did events in Manchester, and I went to a few of the events in Manchester, got talking to Chronicle, and he was trying to sort me out a tryout, basically, for his platform. And there were loads of people that we went through. I think originally I was meant to battle this guy called Dean, who's now known as LS Dean, who I think, you know, has battled loads of guys. Like, he's, you know, fairly upcoming big name on Don't Flop Team W Yorks and stuff. Also went to battle this guy called, I think it's called Two-Putt or Two-Putts or something like that. And I remember I spent like a week thinking of like killer golf puns and shit. And then Chronicle messaged me and he's like, oh, the guy can't do it, he's got to take care of something or whatever. So he was like, oh, do you want to battle this guy called Murta? And I was like, oh, who's Murta? And he's like, oh, he's got a tryout on Don't Flop sort of thing. Like, he's been on Don't Flop. He's battled around the sort of, you know, Derby area and all that sort of stuff. Like, you know, he's more Midlands based, but I think he's in London now. So I was like, yeah, why not? So I found this guy's videos, and, you know, he battled Sordid QC at a Birmingham event. I remember the tryout really well. And they had two tryouts that day, or that event, I think. And I think the first tryout that they did before day one was Marlo versus Josh Fox, which is a famously brilliant tryout, especially by Marlo. But Josh Fox is pretty good, even though he has a round about fucking Marlo's nan, which is quite a weird round, kind of an anti-mom joke round, but whatever. But yeah, so the second tryout of the day was a really shitty tryout, which was Murta versus Sordid QC. Murta chokes quite a bit. Sordid QC, female MC, I should say. Not that really matters, but just to kind of coax it, because Murta is this giant, I mean, Murta, I should say, awesome guy, love the guy. We hung out loads after the event. We'll get into that. But yeah, really, really solid guy. So anyway, I was doing all my research on Murta, had loads of shit written for him. And then I can't remember exactly what happened, but I remember the battle got cancelled for some reason on the Words of Weapon platform. It was always quite a volatile thing. Events seem to be kind of advertised on Facebook and, you know, whatever, but never go ahead or you know, for whatever reason. I get it. It would have been hard to get in, you know, especially kind of a minor league like that. So Murta messaged me. And he was like, oh, why don't we just message King of the Ronalds and see if we can do this on King of the Ronalds sort of thing. And obviously, are you aware of King of the Ronalds at all?
Yeah, I was just about to ask you who they were. So they're like a smaller league, I take it?
Yeah, they're a smaller league. So they were started by kind of ex-Don't Flop affiliates or people who had battled on Don't Flop who were kind of jaded with the experience. Now, Mickey, Worthless, Bowski and Hulk, and, you know, several other people involved as well, sort of Amif and Nux. And yeah, they started this league. And I think originally it was kind of a piss. Like obviously King of the Ronalds, King of the Dot, they're kind of playing on that pretty blatantly with the iconography there and the stuff like that. And it was kind of, you know, they had a lot of Don't Flop people on it. It was a bit joke about. But to be fair, now they build up a really fucking great roster. Not when I was there. Like when I was there, it was still a bit kind of not as compelling. But now they've got tons and tons of great homegrown talent on there. People like Mackenzie and Bard and Cannell and Omar, you know, even Matt Sherry, you know, tons of really, really interesting people on there, you know, that aren't, you know, Don't Flop battlers, then they're King of the Ronalds battlers. So, at this time it was more of a kind of slight joke, and I don't say joke, but you know what I mean? It wasn't as regarded as highly or whatever. And Murta was like, would you be down for that? And I was like, yes. And then if I remember, Hulk put us in a group chat or something, and it got arranged very quickly, and it was in Acton in London. And that's how it came about. It was probably about, I'm trying to think now. So, we would have done the Nader battle in September 2013, and yeah, this would have been like, was it 2015 actually? I think this was.
No, it was 2014.
Was it 2014, the King of the Ronalds? Are you sure?
Yeah. I'm sure the video was from 2014.
Right, okay, I'll just double check. No, it's from 2015, it's from the 1st of July. So yeah, there was quite a gap. So yeah, I did my Nader battle on September 2013, and this battle, well, originally this battle was thought to be lost. I was told that the footage had been lost. But yeah, we did this battle in like April. So what's that like, you know, 18 months or so? Yeah. So pretty big gap between.
Yeah, I mean, so obviously you're now a different persona. You're now a Soliloquy.
Yeah.
Had you prepped in the same way? Was there a different mantra that you were now Soliloquy? Obviously, you'd watched like quite a lot of battles of Murta's.
Yeah. It was Soliloquy was a conscious thing. I mean, obviously there is the kind of clan connotations, especially the K. Why did I put the K? But what happened was Nader was before my year in Manchester, and my year in Manchester was my spoken word year. So, you know, Soliloquy, I really was, you know, I was toying with just calling myself Tom Kwei, you know, like Harry Baker and Simon Mole sort of thing, like the way spoken word eyes just, you know, go by their own name. So I was thinking of going that. But then I think just Soliloquy, I kind of admired the pun selfishly too much. So I prepped as that. But yeah, writing wise, I wanted to be less sexual, you know, less rude, less crude. I wanted to be more writing based, more scheme based as well. You can tell I was in a heavy chill. Yes,
I was just about to say that. I was going to go on to that later. You were very chilly influenced on this one. But, like, was this battle in some sort of, like, church function room? Like, I swear there's, like, some Valentine's Day balloons in the background.
Oh, it was in a shitty function. So, yeah, it was it was in Acton, which I believe is in East London. I don't know London that well. And the place I've never been to before, you know, typical kind of London sort of, you know, district, whatever, you know, just London. And, you know, I get there quite early. There's a giant park opposite the venue. The venue is kind of like almost a club, I think. But I know what you're saying with the community hall church vibe. But it was a club. There was a big bar there and stuff like that. But, you know, it was fucking empty as hell, man. It was quite a big hall.
There's about 20 people there, tops.
You know, it was the first battle of the day, which it wasn't supposed to be, I don't think. But, you know, ended up getting there early. I think that just kind of swayed the decision or whatever. But, yeah, there weren't many people there.
Like, I mean, the element that stands out to me in this video is the terrible host.
Shout out, Hulk.
Yeah, apparently the regular host, Mickey, wasn't answering his phone. So they got, was it Hulk to do it? And he calls you every possible name under the sun except Soliloquy. Mm-hmm. Soliloquy, Soliloquy, Soliloquy. Do you think this was some sort of psychological power play? It is kind of funny that like the first thing you do before battling is kind of like correct him. But, I must admit, like, Murta, to me, he kind of looks like a cross between a hipster Gimli and a hipster Hodor from a Game of Thrones. Yep. Big up them nerdy references. You start this battle off again, and you start off by trying to come up with a creative way of saying that Murta is fat, basically. Mm-hmm. I'm feeling all high and mighty, because if I don't live a life that is so fulfilling, at least when I'm sit down, I'm not so fulfilling. And that gets a big laugh. What's funny about the way you sell the line, though, is like you make a fat guy gesture with your hands. And like, do you feel like bars like that need a certain extra nudge like that with the physicality so that the crowd will like hear it in the way you want it to?
Yeah. I was probably doing that subconsciously, but definitely, you know, you need to kind of, you illustrate the width of a syllable, essentially, and kind of where definitions need to change. You see that a ton in URL. You see that a ton in battle rap, actually. I'm sure most people do that in big or small ways. So, yeah, and just kicking it off again with kind of, like, you know, more of a silly kind of jokey pun that anyone could have said.
Yeah, there's a subtle link between you're saying you're 3,000 times better than someone that you're outcasting, which is a great Andre 3000 reference.
Yeah.
Quite subtle.
Yeah, I thought so. But the problem is outcasting is such a dumb bar. But,
And then, like, you've got the prefix here for your first kind of full scheme, which is, I've already done enough to beat him up, but watch me further beat him up like a beat him up.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get knocked off stage like you're trying to be a Smash brother. He's taking the piss, trying to land a punch for real, but he ain't Soul's caliber. Now, I was disappointed about this scheme because surely you could have fit a Street Fighter bit in there as well. I would have thought Street Fighter, like, you know, this, like, the streets you're battling in front of, I would have thought Street Fighter would have been in there, but I like it. It's kind of like your first, your first full scheme is next, actually.
Yeah, but just to say quickly that Soul Calibur is a reference to Soul, who's, you know, one of the best ever.
Yeah.
But Soul Calibur is one of the most played out bars ever, and I apologise.
I think
getting knocked off the stage for trying to be a Smash brother isn't bad, actually. But again, brother, I'd never like call him brother. So it's just, again, I think this Murta battle, I think writing-wise, is probably my best battle, just in terms of, like, the content. I think there's a lot here, but performance wise I don't like the way I look either. Like, I'm wearing this weird hoodie with this pub, like, I just hate everything about this battle. Like, I don't know, I'm not a fan, but please go ahead.
r/cringe. So profits is something you will never see, but my flow is a virus like Osiris, a rhyming prophecy of Pharaoh. Check this geezer if you really want to see what a noob is. I'm all set, a straight play flying through the skies. This guy's lying locust. Is that locust or locust?
Locust. As in, plague.
Yeah, because he thinks he's defeating me, that he must be in denial. Now, out of the 8 people who attended this battle, there's one guy who's really nodding enjoyment to that scheme in the background. Now, this will be more apparent in your next 2 Don't Flop battles, but do you think that, do you feel certain crowds would be non-receptive to your wordplay?
Yes, I mean, first of all, it's not that good. Like I don't mind.
I like it. Like, I like, but I don't like the way that you, at the end, you go through it all and then call it the pyramid scheme. I think you should just let it go under. Yeah. Like, not a lot of people would get set Geezer.
No.
Either. But, like, I do like, a noob is, like, I think that's very inventive. I remember you telling me that very early on.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of them just don't seem to get it. And no. I feel like maybe if you'd rewritten it slightly, it would have been better saved for a Don't Flop event.
You know, that's the great tragedy, because, like I say, this battle wasn't meant to come out. So after this battle, it was maybe about 2 months later, I got the Don't Flop battle confirmed. And I was struggling to write my second against Turner. And I was just going to cherry pick from this battle, and I was going to include that scheme. And I knew that scheme would have went down on Don't Flop. So, yeah, it is one of those things where, you know, I was quite proud of the pyramid scheme, and, you know, whatever it got.
Mm.
I mean,
yeah. Now, so obviously we mentioned before, big Chilla Jones in influence. Mm. You've got a much more concerted effort to add schemes into your bars now, then?
Hugely. I mean, it's kind of, I don't know. It's weird, isn't it? I was just a chiller fan, so I schemed. It's like I didn't have to. But yeah, that was the kind of wordplay that I liked back then. That was what really excited me. And it's what I found fun to do. And also, it is lazy writing scheming. I'm not going to say it's not. It is filling out your rounds with things, you know, and they weren't direct. What the fuck's Pyramids got to do with Murta, this stoner from fucking, you know, London? Like, nothing. But I said it anyway because, you know, whatever. It doesn't, you know. It's not. Yeah. It's just a flourish. It's a bit of. That's what I wanted to be. I wanted to be known as the bars guy. But like, obviously, it just wasn't. But yeah, I think schemes are just something I found fun to do. And this was like, kind of, I put them all in here. I don't think I schemed as much in the Don't Flop ones.
But you know, I don't think I have to worry too much because you know, Murta comes on screen, and you know, we shouldn't be analysing too much about what they're doing. This is your episode, but what? His first line is just atrocious. This poet lives in Sutton Coldfield, which is a posh bit of Brum. So boring. His cousin's old metal band was called Mosh Pit of Mums. Now I've been rating.
I don't even remember him saying that.
Now I've been rating every single line that I've read on this show, and that's the only one that I've given a 0 out of 10 to, because that is literally one of the worst things. Mosh Pit of Mums. It's like he was so desperate to find something that rhymed with Brum. He was so desperate, and he had to figure out, okay, Mums. But like, why would your cousin have a metal band if you're like in a posh area? It literally makes no sense. But again, I'm an outside fan. I like maybe one Biggie album. I like one Wu-Tang album. I know a bad rap bar when I see one, and this is just such a lame duck effort. Because, you know, like Amazon, delivery is very important. And I know you put a lot of effort into that, but Murta feels like he's a kid in year six who's doing like a kind of PowerPoint presentation. And he's not allowed to read out his notes because the teacher won't let him. So he's doing that, I have to speak slow so I don't choke voice. And there's like, it sucks any sense of passion or effort out of his performance. And then he says, I'll give your mom the shocker and then I'll bolt, no Frankenstein. It's just so ugh. And then like, so many of your opponents do shit like that. He's just ragging on you. Like, why is he spending so long on the fact that you like poetry? Why is he spending so long on the fact that you changed your name? And just as a quick aside, is it possible, Tom, to be in a rap battle without taking your opponent's name and trying to do something with it and using it against them?
It's known as a name flip. And yeah. It's the bread and butter of modern battle rap. I mean,
yeah. And what the fuck was it? Like, he said he wanted to like make you black and blue, and then he pulls out the picture of the infamous Kim Kardashian dress.
Yeah,
it's so forced. Like, oh my god. Like, I know you've talked to me about like guys who come out dressed as American slaves.
Yeah.
Like people doing all sorts of crazy stunts, but they're so terrible. Like he didn't even, like, he's unfolding it like he's folded it like six times. And he's just going and he goes, oh fuck it. Like, he couldn't even stick with it.
I just want to give a quick shout out to Dago DiVarlo, who's a battler. He's been on the show, incredible writer. And I watched one of his battles yesterday, and he had a bar about the dress actually that was so good. He was like,
oh, really?
He was like, get the picture, because when you'll be black and blue when I address shit. You know,
okay.
That's all you got. It's just like a little setup, but yeah, it's so much better. Yeah. Than
obviously, Murta's one of his big in influences. Yeah. That's awesome. But then you come back with some more fat jokes, and come on, who doesn't love fat jokes, people? I mean, again, I have a massive bias being a good friend of yours, but I know what makes you laugh, and I know how you kind of tell jokes and land them. So a couple of them really tickled me, like a hella tubby Teletubby. That's hilarious.
Yeah, it's so really funny. Good.
And then, like, and then you go, fat jokes, I know. They're tired and played. They're more tired and played out than when Mer was a kid and he tried to play out.
That's funny. Sorry. I shouldn't laugh at that one.
Like, you look at the camera in such a cheeky manner. And, like, did you feel like you were kind of like a very intentionally meta battle rapper? Like even from like day one, like you're like looking at the camera like you're Tim from The Office.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really have the in-round charisma, I feel, to really pull off a proper like meta satire sort of thing. But yeah, I mean, it's clear that I'm a fan first, I think. Mm. You know, I'm not a rapper first at all.
Because like, there's got to be this balance between being meta and then just being like a kind of caricature of of yourself and the scheme as well. But you do a mountains bit next, Fuji, Everest, and then you say, "I'll kill a man for his gyro." What the hell does that mean?
Do you not know what that means?
No,
Gyro is a northern expression meaning benefits.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. I'm not quite sure why. Maybe it's kind of like UB40. It's like the name of the government name or something. GRR. I have to look that up. But yeah, no, I remember in the royal family, the brilliant royal family, rest in peace, Carolyn Ahern, there's a character called Gyro Jim. Who's like mentioned off screen, and I remember asking my dad when I was young, "What's gyro?" And he's like, "Oh yeah, it's this." I was like, "Jeez."
And then, do you make a Toy Story 2 reference with
"Do I
too many rappers happy in their rappers like the prospector?"
Ah, yeah, I do.
Yeah. Oh, Stinky Pete, man.
Don't say "fuck the buzz" as well.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
That might have gone over my head a little. But in the third round, you seem to be doing a bit of an Usain Bolt. Like, you seem to have known you've won and, like, you're kind of slowing down intentionally. But to be fair, like, you really don't...
Oh, I lose?
Yeah, see, this is it. Something happens and you don't get the win. And essentially, I was very happy that the host kind of admitted this on camera, that basically... Murta just brought a bunch of his friends with him,
yeah,
and they shouted louder.
Yeah,
and it was a real kangaroo court. It really was. And how did you feel about losing it?
Not that annoyed, really. I wasn't that pleased with the battle.
You knew it was bullshit, though. You knew the verdict was bullshit. Come on,
I do, but I'm not like someone to just hold up winnings and losses and like it's fucking King of the Rolls. Like it's on in that era as well. Yeah. Like it's not, you know, I'm not too bothered to be honest with you. But yeah, I do think I went. I felt Murta came with terrible material. I love Murta as a person. You know, he seems like a great guy. Like I say, afterwards, me, him, and his girlfriend chilled out for a couple of hours with Bard as well, and I met a lot of people actually in the battle world that for the first time that day. And that was a really good experience altogether in that sense, you know. Cool. But battling wise, it was less. But no, Murta's a great guy. But yeah, I felt the material that he brought against me was just uninteresting, and you know, he chokes a little bit. And I don't know. Chris Lee said this recently, but I think he was so right. Like, if I do battle again, which I don't really think I am, to be honest, but like, I guess my regret is out of the four, I never had someone like really go in on me, but.
Yeah, I mean, like, I don't know, but I picture Murta's girlfriend being tiny.
I don't want to make an out of place comment, but she's surprisingly beautiful.
Okay.
Yeah.
All I can say about this battle is, Tom, that I'm sorry that me and Danny were working at Morrison's that night and weren't able to come down and support you, really. But yeah, we're going on to the HD stuff now.
Mm-hmm.
Literally and figuratively, we're on some of the bigger leagues now. This is your battle with Turner.
So they put the poet against the poet.
Yeah.
But Turner's the worst kind. Not the first kind. He's all tongue-in-cheek, young and weak. Doesn't perform. It's just chatter. Got no subject matter on subjects that matter. Just poems about Waitrose and tea that are so fucking forced. This gurning Bo Burnham's about as engaging as divorce.
Mm.
So Turn's mild, just goes round and round and ain't nothing to push past, so let's go through Turn's style.
Yeah, this was, I mean, 2015 was my battling year, it seems. You know, that was about Turner, and obviously went on to battle 142 in the Murta battles, probably all in the space of like 6 months or so.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is what I always dreamed of. You know, I've been thinking of getting a tryout on Don't Flop, and I've been, you know, it was such a weird thing, you know, to actually come. Yeah. I remember I was leaving work and I was getting the train from Litchfield, and I must have sent some message to Bamalam or some shit like that. I think there was some kind of thing on Facebook, like, you know, if you want to get on the next Don't Flop event, send your entry to whatever, you know, we're doing calling outs now or something. Anyway, I was waiting for the train and Bamalam, like, he got his message on my phone, like, Bamalam has accepted your friend request, blah, 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 and read your message. So I kind of followed up on that quickly. I was like, bro, can I get a tryout sort of thing, you know, blah, blah. And he's like, oh, where are you based? I'm based in Birmingham. He's like, oh, I think they're doing Manchester tryouts. So I was like, oh, no, I've got friends in London. I can get to London easily sort of thing. It's not a big deal. I was like, oh, okay then. And then there was kind of a pause, and then I think it was on the same night, maybe maybe it was like the day after, but it was quite soon after that he said, yeah, okay, you're going to be battling this guy called Turner. He's like a poet, spoken word poet. I think he gave me like his SoundCloud or something like that. And, you know, it was quite nice that they paired the poets together, I suppose, to a certain extent. And
yes.
I think I had about a month to write.
So you're out in the park for this one.
Yeah.
Whereabouts was this then? It was in London?
It's right opposite the Ali Pali, the Alexandra Palace. I'll just find the name of the park, actually, because you can see in the back of the battle, I don't know if you noticed the giant, like, statue. Yeah, it's absolutely incredible, that fucking statue. I've never been there before. So, yeah, I'm just on Google Maps now. So, yeah, it's in Alexandra Park is actually where we were.
Oh, okay.
And, just on the kind of little ford or whatever. And it was crazy, man, because obviously it's a battle event, so they say, like, you know, it was an amazing day as well. I remember the weather was absolutely
beautiful.
It was literally one of the hottest days in London. I've never experienced anything like it. I got there really early. I think things were kicking off about, like, fucking, you know, they say, like, 1, but it's not until 3:30 or whatever sort of thing. So I got into London, like, 10, and I'm quite a big artist. Fan, so I just kind of went around the museums, but I kind of couldn't really focus. Like I kind of just kept thinking of my bars, sort of thing, and just kind of parading around London. Yeah. And you know, it was a lovely day, so I kind of didn't even get the tube or whatever. I think I walked for it, you know. Just
You've been to quite a few of these kind of outdoor events subsequently. I mean, is the vibe different than when it's inside a building?
Yeah, I think they're the best events that I've been to, really, just because if you don't want to watch a battle, you can literally just sit on the grass and just get drunk or whatever and just catch up with people, and it's just very, very chilled environment. And then when there's a battle, it's a nice feeling. You're like, oh, shit, there's a battle on. Cool, everyone, you know, whatever sort of thing. So, yeah, personally, I prefer those events. But, yeah, I got there and everyone was sort of congregating around and, you know, there was lots of crowds. I wasn't with anyone. Everyone's in their crews. I didn't really know anyone. Few people sort of recognised me from the King of the Ronalds event or something. I think I saw 142 there, but no one really recognised me. And I remember, like, I was really lame, but like I just sat down and read my Alice Munro short stories in view of all the battlers. I was just like just reading my, like, Canadian, like, small town novel and shit. And
well, you know, that's not the only thing they could have mocked you for, because by this point you're doing Quasi, aren't you? Your art blog, and that also gets brought up by your opponent. We're going to get onto it in a moment. Had we started down in the hole by this point?
No, this is before the podcast. But just to wrap up the Turner thing as well. So I was reading, and like, lots of people there, and then I was looking around. You know, it's probably like 100 people there, just kind of gathered by this statue, and we were going to move about 5 minutes away to like this little ford, like I said, and just kind of start the battles and such. Blazing hot weather, everyone's, you know, sunglasses and shirts and skirts and whatever. And yeah, I see Turner with like 4 or 5 people, and obviously Turner's quite young as well. I think he was like 6.
He was about 12 or something.
Yeah.
Like it was hardly a fair fight from the get-go, but like, he's the weediest kid I think I've ever seen. Like, I could have beaten him at school. That's how bad it was.
I think he was like 16 or whatever. Shout out to Turner. I'm not gonna threaten him.
I could say anything I want. Yeah. I'm not with the show. That's true.
We're all hanging out over, and I saw Turner with like a few girls are all kind of around the same age sort of thing, you know, kind of 16-17, and he was kind of looking at me, and all his friends were looking at me, and I was kind of looking back, and they were kind of looking kind of like almost, I don't know, kind of like, who is this guy sort of thing. And I was just kind of like, whatever, you know, I wasn't really bothered. And then Turner came up to me and was like, you're right, man. And I go, yeah, you're right. And he's like, hey, how you doing? I was like, yeah, I'm cool. And obviously Turner's quite a smaller guy. Like, he was trying to like zone me out or something, and I was just being really, I was like, what's up, man, how's it going? And I was like, oh, how you doing, man? And he's like, oh yeah, you know, just won a spoken word competition in Kent. So, you know, I was like, okay, cool. You know, and he was, I can't exactly remember what he was talking about, but he was sort of bragging about stuff. You know, and I should say as well, Turner, all I had to go on from his SoundCloud were kind of his parody songs.
We're going to get into those.
You know, a little frosty between us, but we just kind of, you know, whatever, and bagging everyone, call everyone to move off, and we go onto the green, and there's a couple of battles before me. York's battled a Moral. There were some other ones as well, a Jace Dishrank maybe, but yeah, I remember there were 3 or 4 battles before me kicked off. You can see me in the background of them. And there were quite a few chokes. I think there were like two or three chokes in like three or four battles. So the vibe was a little bit kind of weird. But I remember after the sort of three battles, they normally do it like in blocks of three. Bagnall said, like, he was kind of looking around. He didn't know obviously who we were. He was like, Soliloquy, Turner, like, you're up next, like this kind of thing. And I remember I had like 15 minutes and there was a tree nearby and I just read over my bars on my phone and just sort of hyped up.
Yeah, so just a quick observation. Mm-hmm. We've gone from three rounds to two.
Yeah.
Why were there only two rounds in this battle, but three in all of the other ones?
Yeah, I think this was a smart move on Don't Flop's part, where basically, yeah, because there were too much choking and stuff, obviously this didn't seem to remedy it much by the chokes, but yeah, the idea was a real tryout, you know what I mean? Not kind of putting the pressure on for 3 1-minutes, kind of, you know, laxing it off a little bit, it's in a park kind of thing, and I think they still do it now, so mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it was a good decision on their part, so it's just a choice of the league.
Your opening line addresses that, and you just mentioned this, that it's a battle between similar styles of battle rap. Are these battles, you know, are the best ones that feature clashing styles, or can similar people work well together? Like,
I mean, absolutely both. You know, some of the best battles in the world, Ogmios versus C Major, for example, maybe even Rome versus Big T. You know, these are huge clashes of styles and personalities. But you know, you can also get these very, you know, maybe a Most Prob versus Soul. You know, they're both incredibly lyrical guys, where you get that sort of idea as well. But I guess they're quite different as well. It doesn't matter. I think the Turner. I think my first round against Turner is probably my favourite round of mine,
yes.
Just in terms of like writing quality, I think it is quite good. I think the second round, like I said, I wanted to use the Murta stuff for the second round. I just couldn't think of enough good stuff in the second to keep it going. But I thought the first was compact. I thought there was some, you know, some good stuff.
It's tight. But these are actually the first bars that indicate the first use of major research against an opponent.
Yeah.
Typically, how long will you have spent building a dossier on this foe? Like,
not long. I mean, I'm given the SoundCloud. I got, you know, his Twitter from the SoundCloud, but there wasn't really anything on there. It's just, I just sort of spoke about the songs and stuff. There wasn't, you know, it's just what's there. It's just kind of, you know, it's fair picking. So I'm not going to sort of mention
Baywatch with an E.
Baywatch with an E. I think like, what is it to say, like, you know, it just goes round and round and nothing to push past, so let's go through turn style.
Yes, I knew you wouldn't be able to resist turn style.
I love that one.
I saw that one coming. But there's this one line that I love. Like, no subject matter on subjects that matter, just poems on Waitrose and tea that's so fucking forced. This gurning Bo Burnham is about as engaging as divorce. And then bam. The crowd are into you, and you know, going back to what I was saying about the last battle, you have a bigger, more well-versed crowd.
It's safe
to say, and more of your material seems to be landing. So do you feel like that this was definitely more your crowd this time?
Totally. I mean, obviously, yeah, you want a battle on Don't Flop. Yeah, of course you do. But you know, something you might not realise as well, Sam, and I've had you know, some of the people that tried out the event, I've had on Jason Morrill, a great episode.
Yeah.
You know, we mentioned there were some legends in the crowd. Not only obviously there in Bagdorn, all the Bamalam and all that, but you know, Tony was there, Shuffle was there, later on C Major and Cracker were there. You know, there were tons of big names there. So that added to it as well. And getting that reaction did feel good. It was just a very weird, it didn't feel natural being in that ring, having all those eyes on you, being such in the out open, especially as well. I wish I didn't wear sunglasses as well. I think even
I like that. I think it's douchey in a good way.
I mean, it is sunny as fuck, but I didn't need them on. Like, I think I don't know, it's just a personal pet peeve.
The main feature in this battle for me is just like in your journey, the savageness in the way you attack him. Like, could you detect weakness and you pounce on it? Because, like, I mean, like, you just dismantled this guy's entire catalogue of SoundCloud work. And, like, I've known you for a few years. I know that you have this innate ability to identify, hone in, and then destroy the thing that someone is most sensitive about.
Yeah.
Like, if you want to take the piss out of my podcast, you could just say how many episodes you do a week versus how many episodes I do a week, and you can crush me in a second.
Jesus Christ.
It's just easy for you to do. You're like a fucking panther spotting a weak gazelle. Like, Baywatch, hashtag...
Are they in the same habitat?
Yeah. Like, Baywatch and hashtag thug life. Right. Like you get the crowd to laugh at him, not just with you. And
I laughed quite a lot actually about the Baywatch line, yeah.
And the cameraman does this quick shot of Turner's face, and he just looks horrified. Like, I would feel sorry for him if I wasn't like on your side, but like there's this great little closing, like, kind of mini scheme that you do for the first round, and it's only like one line, but it always stuck with me. At the moment, I'm just A minor G, but soon I'll be major C, and like I just like that. And like, obviously, it reminds me of the B sharps from The Simpsons.
Yeah, it's just, the thing is though, like, again, I don't know why I was so naive. There's so many like chord schemes.
Yes,
Schiller had like, I leave a G flat.
And there's a comment on the YouTube video here that sums up not just my own, but I think a lot of people's opinions out there of Turner's first line, and it reads, "To be or not to be, ... shuts off video."
Yeah.
And I couldn't put it better myself, really. I know you haven't got a bad thing to say about Turner, but like, it's just, to be or not to be. It's like he's got a very weird, obviously you should be doing spoken words, stay in Kent kind of vibe to it. And it becomes increasingly clear that whilst you might get flack for not being gangster enough, man, this guy just takes it to the next level. He comes across the kid at school who would like really, really like suck up to teachers so that he could become deputy head boy. And like, his bars consist only of two things: forced Shakespeare references and incest jokes. And like, I know there's a lot of incest in Shakespeare, but that's it. There's no like depth to anything he's saying. Mm. No, whatever. Like, it's all very surface level stuff. And the only line that's half funny, more inbred than the filling of the sandwich, he fucking stumbles like halfway through it.
And again, that's an old joke.
Like, yeah, it is. And then we come on to the scheme that only a few of your friends and I ever saw coming.
Yeah.
But like, not only did you have an art blog that where you discussed the work of Turner, but that year, was it Mike Lee who did?
Yeah, so, One of my, you know, Sam, I'll have to say it's one of my favourite films ever now. I've rewatched it recently, Mr. Turner. I don't know if anyone's seen it.
Like the biopic with Spall.
Timothy Spall, yeah, of JMW Turner, you know, the incredible expressionist. Impressionist, whatever you want to call him. So I wanted to get that in there. Obviously, he was cool. I remember when I first got it confirmed, I went home and it was, you know, this was like June, July, so it was really good weather. Went into the garden, again, just kind of brainstormed ideas and Turner. And then pretty much the first thing I thought of was the painter Turner. And I was like, oh, I've got to get a bar in there somewhere. But I was like, that's too lame. No one's going to know that. But I was like, oh, Mr. Turner came out like a few months ago. Surely, you know what I mean? Like,
Yeah. Maybe.
I think Shuffle Tea. He nods actually at that bar. I think he does. Yes. I think if you look carefully.
I'm getting impressionistic with this art. You should call me Mr. Turner, your senior. And I think it's a very clever way, because you actually separate Mr. and Turner with a little comma, and it's done in the exact right way that you have to think about it. And then you have these two really funny breaks where you don't flow, but you just kind of let him have it, and the crowd love it. Like, I hate everyone your age. And then you say, you're shit. Seriously, I can't deal with you. And like, you're not really rapping at that point. You're kind of almost just like acting in a kind of spoken word way. And it kind of breaks the flow, and Turner really doesn't do anything like it. And it kind of separates you two in a very nice way. And then you close with a line that I never knew I liked until I heard it fresh. But like, you know, kind of like in doing the down in the hole, when we'd listen to a Tom Waits song over and over again, and we didn't really think we'd like it, but we go back. And I'd forgotten all about this one. And you're like, so don't flop, hook me up with a real opponent, and I'll show those milli figures, because I'll just put this kid's blocky style in a bag. Minifigures.
Yeah.
And was this at the point where, because obviously Lego minifigures now are probably almost as popular as Lego itself now. Mm-hmm. Like, you can go into any supermarket, like a W.H. Smith, $1.99, you get a Lego minifig with a base. And that just started at this point, really, hadn't it? It just kind of taken off.
I think it was when I was aware of it, yeah.
Yeah, like the you know, but like obviously things like the Simpsons minifigs hadn't come out. The solid gold minifig that started a mad craze.
Actually, I was in Tesco yesterday, and at the sort of cash in point, you know, where you self check out, whatever, they had a box of minifigures. The old, this makes me sound like a mad collector. I'm not, but I do quite like them, like you say. And they were half price. They were $1.25 because it was like the old series. So I just picked up one, and I actually got like the Archangel guy. I don't know if you've seen that one, but it's kind of like got this giant like Mayan headdress and wings and shit.
It's on my
desk right now. It's looking pretty badass.
So yeah, that was the turnabout. You must have felt pretty good about this one. You kind of nailed it on the head.
Yeah.
It just kind of goes well. I feel like you are right. Your first round's very, very strong. I would have liked, just for completion's sake, to have a third round, but maybe that would have been at your detriment. So perhaps it all worked out in the end, really.
Yeah, it did, and it was a fantastic experience. I did feel it went well, even though I kind of had that minor choke, and I did get the victory as well, the judge victory, which allowed me to get the next battle. And Turner has never been on battling since. I think he's on more in spoken word now. Will Turner, I should say. Google this guy, check him out. He's a great spoken word poet on the come up, doing really good things. But
isn't Will Turner the main character from Pirates of the Caribbean?
I believe he is.
Yeah,
and both of them are blooming. So
yeah.
And
wooden. Yeah.
Yeah. So the rest of the day, just got fucked up, watched the rest of the battles. I remember I watched Press One versus Crafty, the first time I'd seen any either of them. I thought that was a fucking crazy good battle. I've had both of them on the podcast since. Such a good clash. And surreal, really. It was fun. It definitely, was a fun trip. One of the funny things that happened as well was, because obviously this was like Saturday afternoon, hot summer's day kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So there's a big crowd in the park and everyone's laughing and watching. So often you would get like clumps of tourists coming to see what was going on. And I remember once there was like this German family of like three young daughters, this dad and this mom, and they came up and there was like this battle. I can't remember who it was, but like, fuck off, suck my fuck it, like, all this sort of shit like that. And they scurried off really quick, sort of thing. And that was quite weird. They just kept happening throughout the day. Like every battle, there'd be like another sort of Italian cohort just kind of cheaping in. But like, I understand that, it is quite a unique thing to see. But I happy with it. Went really well. And again, glad the material got off. Felt confident in the material. And at this point, I think I was wanting to be, more consistent with it, but I didn't push anything. And then about a week, 2 weeks later, I got a message from Bamalan because, I'd won my tryout. They paired me up against someone else who had won his tryout at the same event. That being 142, who people will be aware of. It's a bit bigger name now in Don't Flop. And
this is, this is your 142 belt.
And then this is in Fiddler's Elbow, classic training days kind of event sort of things. So in Don't Flop, we're doing a lot there, putting the tryouts and the lower tier guys together. Great events as well. This was a really, really good one to go to. Andy Jones is actually there, a good friend of ours.
He's a busking still, isn't he?
Yes, he is. He's a great busker in London. But yeah, he was good enough to come down for that. And another exciting one. I think, probably reaction-wise, probably my best battle. I'm not as into the writing, but,
Look, this is your fourth and final battle here, Tom. But before we get into the meat of things, there's one question that I'm not sure even I know the answer to this. Mm-hmm. Why was this your last battle?
I don't know. I just didn't care anymore. I don't know what it was. I think, at this point, after the 142 battle, which did get good reaction and stuff. So the 142 battle comes out, and then around that time, I think we're just starting to do the Tom Waits podcast. So I kind of had something to, really keep me occupied and like creatively. So I wasn't as yearning, I suppose, for anything, to be honest with you. And then by the time, because I mean, to be fair, this 142 battle came out effectively a year ago, September 2015 sort of thing, and did the Tom Waits podcast, and after Tom Waits podcast, I'll start Battle Rap Resume. And I think it's a case of being too close to it now. Like, I enjoy being a pundit more. Like, I don't think I was that good, and I'm not saying that to be bashful. Like, I just don't. There's some lines in there that make me laugh, but like, as a complete battler, what was my future? Nothing really. Yeah. And I don't, like, I'm really, like, honestly, it's a genuine honor to have a tryout and then another battle on Don't Flop. That actually blows my mind. Like, it makes me so happy. And to go any further, there's nothing I could take from it, because I know that, like, I would just be beaten by so many people. Could beat me quite easily. But
do you not feel like that you were not on this steady upwards progression, both in your delivery and your writing?
I guess that's fair. Yeah, I mean, like,
did you know going in that this was going to be your last battle?
No, I didn't. I wasn't really planning. I remember I wanted to battle Sleepy G for a time, who's way, way bigger than me. I know you won't be aware of him, but but there wasn't really anyone that I was really after. And then I think there were people coming through, like tryouts at that time that were coming through, like heretic and crafty, especially, mm-hmm. especially crafty, that I was like, fucking hell. I was like, you know, the guy is so good. And it just made me think, but yeah, I know what you're saying, but let's say I get in the ring now and I battle a Don't Flop. Like, my one fear is that just the podcast is such an angle.
Oh, well, like people could just come for you.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not that anything would happen. You know what I mean? Like, okay, I'm not, because I'm kind of gifting that to an opponent in a sense. But you know, yeah. Whatever.
We can all live in a world of what ifs, couldn't we?
We can, and I think partially as well. It's more an extension of my interest in creative writing, really, at the moment. Like, I just don't really. I used to write poems all the time and perform and all that sort of stuff. But at the moment, I busk all the time now. You know, I play music all the time in Oxford, and then you know, do the podcast and whatever else. So I've just kind of, I haven't really got any time, and I'm kind of, like I say, I'm just occupied. I'm just not really wanting, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we're already doing the podcast by this point, but there must have been some initial creative spark that made you must have known you'd eventually be doing a show like Battle Rap Resume. Like, had the seed been planted at this point?
You know, seriously, not, no. I think when we were midway through doing the Tom Waits podcast, which was I appreciate most people haven't listened to it, but you know, do check it out if you just like my voice. But yeah, there's like, what, 45 fucking hours of it or whatever we've gone through the albums. But it was really fun because, you know, we were getting recognised, we were getting quite good download numbers and people emailing and stuff, and it really made it feel real. It made it feel less than 2 minutes just chatting and more like a real show. And you know, as we're nearing the close of the podcast, we both said like, oh, we want to just keep podcasting because it's really fun. And like, you know, maybe we are going to do the Beatles one day, aren't we, Sam? We're going to come back for that.
Yes,
and,
definitely
review all their albums in a few years time when we've closed off our other adventures online. But yeah, so I knew there was something there, but I hadn't really for some reason, even though battle rap was just such a thing for me, it's been such a huge obsession for me, I never really considered. Actually, that's not true. I had done one episode with Danny maybe like literally 2 years ago called Battle Chat. This is when I was
battle
in Manchester.
Chat, yeah.
And the idea of that show was, and we recorded one episode that I probably still have on my laptop, it wasn't bad or anything. The idea of that episode was, it would be me and Danny, and each show would be framed around a battler. So I think the first one we did was villain for some reason, the acclaimed you know, such a good battler villain, and we would just talk about their battle. So it's kind of like Battle Rap Resume, but not as good because it wasn't a guest, so it was just kind of us giving our opinion or whatever. So we had done something like that, and that's where the theme tune comes from. The Battle Rap Resume theme tune is the Battle Chat theme tune, done by Alex Cottrell, by the way. Thank you so much. I love that theme tune. It's quite funny, actually. I was at an event, and Amif, a good friend of the show, said to me, oh, I really like the Battle Rap Resume theme tune. You know, it sounds a bit like a video game, you know? And I was like, it's interesting you say that, because the guy who did it, Alex Cottrell, a good friend of mine from university, is a video game composer. That's his job.
So cool.
I know. If you've ever played, he does a lot of Steam games. But yeah, check him out. Search Alex Cottrell. He did Company of Heroes as well. He did one of their Russian expansion packs. Like, the guy's fucking so, so talented. Really, really cool guy. But the Battle Chat episode never came out. I don't know why. We just couldn't really be bothered to do it or whatever. So I had done a bit of battling before. And then it was at the end of the year, at the end of December 2015, where I was pretty fucked up in my room or whatever. And I was just, I think something just hit me out of the blue. And I was like, fuck, I could do a show where I'd discuss a battler's career like Joe Rogan, but just a battler sort of thing, and we can just go in depth and sort of thing. And that'll, you know, that'll be perfect because that'll offer all the insight and I'll do them and whatever. And I remember I messaged Shockster Rebel, like who was the first guest on the show, on Twitter, kind of asking him. We'd sort of spoken back and forth a little bit because obviously I was a huge fan. The guy is absolutely incredible. Still one of my favorite battlers. And he's such a gent. He was down for it straight away. And I think we did the first episode early January, and then I messaged Crafty as well. And from there, really, but it really was not premeditated. I wasn't even thinking about it, you know, the 1-4-2 battle or whatever. It's one thing I considered.
So cool. Obviously, now, you know, moving back onto the battle, if I'm not mistaken, is that who acts as MC in this battle, Tom?
It is, yeah. I mean, he looks a little bit different from his earlier incarnations. He's kind of going on more of the sort of Jesus boho hippie vibe right now, but you know, pulls it off, man. He's a stylish dude.
And obviously, you've just done a fantastic episode with him. Let me just preface people. I love Battle Rap Resume. I don't like battle rap, but the interviews you do are absolutely incredible. Are you still on for doing the part two of the interview where you discuss the foundation of the flop?
Yeah. This was something we agreed from the off.
Okay.
to do an episode. I knew it was going to be a long, long episode with her, but to do an episode where we spoke concurrently about Don't Flop and his career, I just felt that would have just been overload. Because essentially what I want to do with the Don't Flop kind of episode with her is go through year by year and event, you know, big events and moments that happened and what went down there and that sort of thing. And then more minutiae stuff, upload schedule and editing and stuff like that. But yeah, the R episode just broke 2,000 views, actually. And this is Friday morning we're recording this, and it only came out Tuesday morning. So to get 2,000 views in 3 days, and we've only got 800 subscribers, is crazy, man. Like, you know, people are really responding to the show well.
That's really, it is really cool. It is really cool. Could you please describe 142 a bit for me, please, Tom?
142, you know, I knew him beforehand because we met at the King of the Rounds event, and then I saw him at the Don't Flop, you know, the outdoor tryout event sort of thing. You know, he's quite a sort of skinny dude. He looks
kind of like Turner mixed with Eddie Redmayne covered in shoe polish. He's right. He's got very big lips. But
Yes, he does. Yeah. I always found him quite dead behind the eyes when he spits as well. There's never any conviction, and he just kind of froze. But like recently, he's been more heralded. He did a little video about his depression, and Don't Flop, I think they retweeted it or put it on the Facebook, and he got like millions of views, man. It was crazy. Like, you know, the guy got a lot of claim of that, which is great. And you know, he's more of an on-beat guy now. But yeah, them pairing us up, it was kind of like, I just wish I went up against someone a bit more interesting from those tryouts. Just personally, I found him quite hard to write for. Like, most of my bars are about how boring and uninteresting he is, which isn't the best
for interesting me. yeah
I'm gonna reign forever like British weather. This prick is never scripting better. Your body frame makes me uncomfortable. You look like bones in a sack. If you were literally choking, it'd do more harm than good to pat you on the back.
So this is your only battle where you don't start. And like, I mean, you know, tell me, like, you're not a freestyler. So are you actually listening to what he's saying, or are you just ignoring him and thinking about your own bars over and over and over again?
I mean, yeah, like most battlers, you're thinking of your first bar. Keep that lush in the brain. But yeah, I mean, kind of just, again, it was really weird because there were so many big people there. Like, you can see Raptor there just like watching over it and shit. And, you know, so many other people, Briggsy at the front as well. And it was busy. It was a busy event, you know, those sort of Fiddler's Elbow events. You know, they've done so many events in that room, Don't Flop, and a lot of the events you watch on YouTube, you know, the room's half empty or whatever. But for this, I think it was a free event. It was in like late August or whatever. Everyone was down for it. It had some great battles on the card. Everyone was there already. But yeah, I was just kind of sort of getting in the mood, really, and getting, because, you know, I'm sure most battlers will tell you that moment when you say your first word and you realize that everyone's listening is very surreal. You know, everything's been building up to this. It's kind of like, you know, not the Olympics of that grand. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, if you've been training for fucking 4 years to run for 10 seconds, like, it's just when you take that first step, it's like, fuck.
Now, 142 is definitely your most competent opponent to date. Like, clearly he has some experience, he's done some research on you. He's a mixture between kind of Turner and Nader in his kind of personality and persona. But like, he just does a lot of the shit that Turner did, though. Like, ooh, you rhymed gay queer with Shakespeare. Well done, man. And like, I would have respected his dig at you, saying that he only took this battle for the sake of progression, if his voice didn't painfully crack like halfway through. And like, he says, like, do you think I'm just kind of some skinny dweeb who can't back up his talk? And like, I'm thinking, and everyone else must have been thinking, yeah, actually, yeah, you are. But like, anyway, that's probably the strongest set you've ever had to follow, but you still kind of seem pretty chill, and you go right, you leap right into it, and you win over the crowd instantly with, I'm going to reign forever like British weather.
Yeah.
And people just like, it's like, bam, you're back onto it. And
I've had that for years, by the way. I've had that
really?
Line. Yeah, years.
And there's this next bit that I didn't know where you were going with it. And he's like, your body frame makes me uncomfortable, which gets a laugh.
Yeah.
Then he's like, you look like bones in a bag. If you were literally choking, it would do more harm than good to pat you on the back. And like, even I went, it's tight. Like, and like, it's just like, it's because he looks so funny that works as well.
Because he went first as well, crucially.
Yeah. And we get the typical Kwei looks at the camera, like the office moment again, that you just can't seem to resist.
Canterbury.
Yeah. And you're getting the laughs again. And with an opponent with a name like 142, of course you were going to do a name flip. Mm. It's some sort of maths joke. It goes down surprisingly well. I'm going to cut 142 down to size like long division. And like there's at least seven different nods and a ooh in the background.
That's a value. Anyone with numbers in their name, you sort of.
Yeah. But one of your biggest reactions ever, and is one that I don't think on paper is that funny, but when you think about it again, kind of like cake mix, you symbolise dickhead like a Carling can. Now, that line would normally have just been sufficient enough for me to talk about it anyway, because it is just funny at the end of the day. But the next part that connects it to the issue is telling of what point in your life you were in when you were writing it, because actually we have a reference to the best podcast ever. Mm-hmm. Better than my show, better than your show, better than down in the hole. You symbolise dickhead like a Carling can. I entranced the narratives like Dan Carling can, so it only makes sense that I go hardcore in your history in the third round. Now, obviously, we are both massive hardcore history fans. Mm-hmm. It is the best podcast ever made. It's so professional. It's entrancing. It's enrapturing. I remember it took me 3 hours to get home one night, and I just put on a whole thing, and the night flew by. Obviously, anyone who listens to the Joe Rogan Experience is also a de facto hardcore history fan.
Yep.
But dude, it was a ballsy move to throw in a Dan Carling reference.
It was. I shouldn't have, in hindsight. And I mentioned this to Sol, actually, who's current Don't Flop champ, incredible writer. And he was like, you know, just do it, man. Just put in whatever you want in your bars. You've got to make them, you know, yours. You've got to enjoy them. And he is right. But yeah, shout out Dan Carling. Common Sense as well is another one of his podcasts. But yeah, he is one of mine and Sam's personal heroes, because hardcore history is, there's like nothing else like it for me personally.
And again,
basically what happens is the kind of 3 hour episodes will go over major historical events. So there's one called The Red Square, which is a great one that I love, all about kind of communism in like 1950s post-war America, and the, you know, all that sort of stuff, and McCarthyism and all that sort of shit, and the antecedents of that. So and he just goes deep. He'll read from people's journals and newspaper articles and his own analysis, and it's wonderful, man. Wonderful shit.
And it's all out on YouTube now. He's finally allowed people to put it up on YouTube for free, which is really cool.
But okay.
It's a lot of his older episodes. But like, a lot of people laughed, though, which surprised me quite.
I'd be surprised if a lot of people got it.
Yeah. But obviously, you haven't got any bars about small soldiers or ghost shit then.
No.
Then 142 comes back with what feels like a very quick round, where he seems to just take the piss out of your lines against Murta, and he seemingly ends his round in the middle of a line, but oh well.
By the way, one of the lines that he takes the piss out of is one of my favourite lines. Like,
you take the pee out of the league because you don't flow.
You don't flow, so you'll never take any pee out the league.
Yeah.
I thought that was quite good.
It is, man, but, you know, everyone's a critic, aren't they? Then you're back in your second round in a similar fashion, whereby you deconstruct his bars from his own battles at King of the Ronalds. Now, do you feel like...
This round was badly judged, badly written, yeah.
Because, like, you do the thing that he just did. Now, do you feel like in any other competition, is going first always preferable? So, you know, appear to be copying? Or are there cases where it's better to go second?
It's better to go second if you can freestyle, of course, because then you get three chances to rebuttal rather than two. But other than that, it's kind of, yeah, it's, you don't know what's going to be said, so it's hard to make predictions for this sort of stuff. But my idea for this round was basically King of the Ronalds and Don't Flop, you know, have a lot of kind of, whether it's genuine or not, animosity perceived between them. I wanted to stoke that fire, because at this point he was very much a King of the Ronalds boy. I think he's more Don't Flop now, 142. So yeah, I wanted to kind of, I wanted to dig into that bit more. And my idea was that, you know, he's been on Ronalds his whole life, so he'll be shit. So I wanted to do like a sort of supersize me Morgan Spurlock thing, like, you know. So I'm like, I think I have this terrible where I'm like, you gormless jerk sock Morgan Spurlock.
Yeah, I don't know Ronalds what that was about. Life.
Yeah, was that not clear then, the Morgan Spurlock thing? I guess if you don't know King of the Ronalds, it's less.
I was just thinking, why is he talking about the supersize me guy? I don't know what, but. In the third round, though, you have quite a lot of lines that I really do like.
Yeah, third round's pretty big, actually, yeah.
I'm forever writing, never stationary, I penetrate with the pen and paper. I like how you say it, it's like you wrote 1,000 schoolyard jokes and thought right, something left to right. Mm-hmm. If he isn't stumbling in his battles, he's literally stumbling in his battles, always walking left to right.
He does that. He does pace weirdly.
I hate the way this cunt walks. Your first C bomb, and it goes down well. Yep. It's again like when you were saying to Turner, just like I hate everyone your age. You're shit. Seriously, I can't deal with you. You break the flow. It's like, you know, in like comedy films when they go, and then it's, you know, that in that silence you add this like this atomic bomb of just like, ouch, that's actually quite mean. And you go on to end your career on quite a high note when you continue this thread with, I also hate the way this cunt talks. You go from shitty bar to shitty bar like a night out in Scunthorpe, which absolutely wrecks the house.
Huge. People absolutely biggest reaction I've ever got. Yeah.
Yeah. And then you do this great little bit of physical comedy to top it all off. Your delivery is dribbly. It's less gum bars and more gum bars.
Yeah.
And where did that come from?
I don't know. I like the idea. Originally, it was meant for DNA, who's a battler you won't be aware of, but he has like a missing tooth and does gum bars a lot. So I wanted I always had like gum bars for him. And obviously, I'm never ever going to battle DNA. So I just yanked it out and put it in there. I don't know. It was kind of, yeah.
Yeah. So is there no official policy on making sure they announce who won? Or are these extra battles designed to be argued over in the comments section?
Yeah, I mean, Don't Flop at a time were the Judge League. You know, that was kind of their thing. And there still are judge battles from time to time. But if you're on extra, you know, especially, they're most likely going to be promo just for sakes of argument, like you say.
Yeah. And I guess that brings us to the end of your battle rap career, Tom, really. Yeah. Like, I mean, when you still have a career in battle rap, and you've kind of already answered this now, but do you think there's any possibility that you could ever get back in the ring, Rocky, you know, use your newfound fame and merchandising revenue to your advantage?
I think like the right opponent, maybe, like if someone came along.
Controversy, yeah.
Yeah, I've got to be honest with you, like, you know, I do feel like I have writer's block to a certain extent, but I don't know if that's something that will be uncorked, like it kind of was with 142 when I was kind of, you know, in a group chat and someone was like, you guys are battling, and then suddenly you can, you know, ideas just spark out. So maybe I should just take an opponent and just jump in the deep end, because yeah, I'm listening back, they're not bad, and like you say, the presence has been a bit more, and maybe for the podcast, just on a one-off kind of new promo, by the way, you know.
I mean, like, is there anyone who would
ghostwrite for me? I hope
is there anyone who is a Don't Flop fan that doesn't know about Battle Rap Resume? Because I mean, they retweet the fuck out of you.
They do, but I mean, what do retweets mean, you know?
Yes, I suppose, but you know, I'm sure fans of the show would love it purely just for the novelty.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. And I think, you know, I am warming to it, I must say, so who knows. And Training Days are sort of Don't Flop's kind of lower tier division with Danny Jack and stuff, so I know those guys, so maybe I can reach out. Or
so I know you've started doing some new types of content with the show. You've got a new collaborator who's helping you with like thumbnails and stuff.
Yeah.
But what are the other things that we can look forward to with Battle Rap Resume now that we've reached this 50th episode milestone? Are we going to get any Let's Plays or a YouTube drama or fake prank videos?
I do like to plan ahead, and I do, you know, one of the things that I am making always is the top 10 most disliked videos, where I do like the commentary over the top. I really like doing those sort of videos. I think they're really fun to do. They're really fun to write as well. And I just finished top 10 most disliked King of the Dot videos. It's like 35 minutes long. Like, I went deep on quite a lot. And anyone listening, battles like Daylight Real Deals on there, and Saurus Ilmac Po Rich Diaz, as well as the King of the Dot blackout announcement, and some shitty battles like, what is there, Warbox versus Caliente, GQ Styles, you know, terrible people.
Are there any more shitty, I think you should do one where you just like talk about like obscure shitty videos. Like, I love it when you talk about weird music videos.
Yeah,
that don't forget, because they're just mind-boggling.
Yeah, I could actually do like something on just music videos. You know, there is a lot of things planned for the show. I want to go through my old bars as well, my notebook. That could be quite fun. I don't quite know how I'd do that. If I do it on cam, that'd be easy to do. Another thing as well that someone suggested suggested on the email, please email battlerapresume, by the way, if you want to get in touch with the show, was to do like a review of a classic event. So say like Don't Flop's fourth birthday is highly regarded as one of their best events. Like me and someone else would sort of review the event entirety in retrospect and go through every battle that happened and sort of just talk about them. Because I think fourth birthday especially has some incredible, like so consistent. So yeah, and then just, you know, battlerapresume interviews are always going to keep coming out twice weekly.
Murder Mook going to be on at some point.
Murder Mook, you know, I mean, I had Sue Surf on, and it's very much a case where, you know, you get guests that I think can set precedent. I think early on when I had Chiller, that was a big thing, you know, incredible.
That was a very big thing. Even I knew who Chiller Jones
well,
was.
Well, I mean, me and Danny were just going about him all the time, but no, yeah, he is obviously, you know, incredible. So yeah, and then when I think I had Ur on, recently, that means I can kind of let anyone in the UK now, or I would say they belong to me, but you know what I mean, like there's respect, people know that I put out a good show and that I'll give them respect. And I think having Sue Surf on, who I appreciate you're not aware of, but he's one of the biggest guys in the entire game, like huge URL battle rapper, millions of views, I think that'll be pretty big, and I think that will allow me to get the more URL guys that I want to get. I mean, Mook is not someone that I'm necessarily a fan of so much, but one of the
Surf's against Big T, wasn't he?
So, yeah, they battled in that shoe shop. That was him. That was Surf, man. That was crazy shit. New Jersey shit. Shout out Surf. But yeah, more people on the show, more event recaps, more interviews, more everything, you know.
You ever going to be on camera?
Yeah, I think some guy reached out to me actually quite a while ago, who films for some spoken word night, I think in Bristol. And he said that he goes to a lot of the London events, and if ever I'm at a London event and he wants to do any camera stuff, he'd like film it. So I am going to Next in Line, which is the Shocks Tony one. I don't know when this is coming out. This might actually, let me just check there when this is actually going to come out. This episode is going to come out. Yeah, okay, just before 8th birthday is going to come out. Okay, right, good. So Next in Line has already happened. How crazy was that event? I don't know. I'm in the past. It's the 30th of September, but who knows? I can't wait. I'm going to Next in Line. But I'll also be at 8th birthday in some capacity, probably in London. So yeah, I would like to do a few battlerap.com, as people are aware of, like Chris Mitchell and stuff and Smart Alex, just like on-cam interviews at the venue or some shit. That might be cool to do, like, you know,
you could, yeah.
Out in. But I don't know whether it might be a case of, like, I'm just way better doing podcasts, you know, or maybe I'm worse. I don't
know. Who knows?
But more content like that. And in terms, I mean, the beautiful thing is about the show, like, it kind of keep going forever, can't it? Just in terms of interviews, like, you know, there's probably about, off the top of my head, I don't know, 300 maybe people that I want to get on the show, just battlers from all the different leagues all over the world and stuff. And then when I've had those on, I have them on again. Like, it can just keep building. Yeah. I've already had quite a few people, like Def and Crafty and stuff, on again just to discuss other things. So, you know, it's just a great network.
So before we get on to your final five questions, I'm going to do my plug, if that's cool.
Yeah.
So obviously me and Tom did Down in the Hole. We went album by album through the work of Tom Waits. Enough about Tom Waits, but I kind of created a sister show for that in a sense. Stepsister, twice removed, but it is quite incestuous. It's called Paul or Nothing. I'm not sure what the Venn diagram crossover between battle rap fans and Paul McCartney fans are, but I'm sure there's at least two of you out there.
Okay.
But you know, it's always nice to plug your own shit. I go back album by album. I review Paul McCartney's work. I talk about his life story, the people he worked with, instruments he used, things like that, inspired songs, that kind of thing. And then it's just talk about the music, really, and it's going really well. I've got my literally, as soon as we're done with this episode, I'm going to start an interview with an author who writes books on Paul McCartney. I've got our friend Maurice, who's a fantastically musically gifted man, is going to come on. And my dad, actually, he saw that I did the show, and it turns out he did some joinery work for Paul McCartney's keyboard player. So I'm trying my hardest to get him to come on the show, because that'd be incredible. But yeah, please, any Paul McCartney fans, any Beatles fans, check out Paul or Nothing. It's one of the featured channels on the Battle Rap Resume channel on YouTube as well. I also kind of do another podcast that I haven't really done anything. It's kind of like your gesticulations. Like, right. I started it, and it's like I haven't done anything for about 3 months, but it's called Only Fools and Podcasts. Annoyingly, there's probably more Only Fools and Horses fans who like Don't Flop than Paul McCartney, but yeah. I've been reviewing every episode of Only Fools and Horses. I've done the first four. I'm definitely going to get the next two out within the next 2 months.
Okay.
And then I'm probably going to do it a bit slower. But yeah, I'll just go through all the episodes. I talk about the production of each episode. I talk about the jokes, the writing, and then I'll do a little preamble with every episode where I'll talk about the actor or a character, trivia, that kind of thing. And to be fair, I've got more followers on my Twitter for that than I do for Paul or Nothing, where most of my passion goes. So who knows? I might have to keep both alive on life support. But yeah, let's do your final five.
Well, I just guess if anyone's enjoyed us talking as well, check out Tom Wade's podcast. Because there's 25 episodes, something like that.
Yeah, we do have a certain banter, and we're going to be doing more bonus episodes for the YouTube for that as well.
Yeah,
and it's a great thing to pop on the CV. But Tom,
yeah.
Besides, you know, me plugging Paul or Nothing and Only Fools and Podcast, check them out. What is your favorite Don't Flop battle?
Favorite Don't Flop battle: Soul versus Matter.
Favorite King of the Dot battle, my friend. Oh, it's getting tense, folks.
That's actually like
you've been asking these questions to. So
yeah, many. No, that's the thing. That's the thing. It's so difficult. I really like Remy D versus QP.
No idea who they are, but it was a good battle.
It's a great battle.
Favorite URL battle:
Chiller versus JC.
Yeah, obviously. Now, this is the one where I think I might know the answer. Yeah. But what's your favourite film, Tom?
Favourite film? I have to say, can I say two or can I just say one?
In joint first place, we have...
In joint first place, we have 12 Angry Men.
Yeah.
And The Wrestler.
And The Wrestler, of course. Even though, probably like... as a group, you, me, and Danny, our favourite kind of conjoined film would always be Goodfellas.
Yeah.
We've had, like, we actually mentioned Ryan. I'm not sure if you've ever mentioned Ryan on the show before, but we had a Goodfellas night once about 3 years ago, and he made for all of us a massive, massive plate of giant meatballs, and we all got so high and so drunk, and it was the best night of my life. It was so fucking good. Watching Goodfellas with meatballs, it was the best thing ever, and he put, like, mozzarella on top. It was fucking incredible. And
who's meant to like cut the onion? Really, you let it sizzle in the pan or something? That's what they do. Yeah. In prison.
No, I think he actually cut the garlic with a razor blade. I think he actually did.
And then he stabbed that guy with a wig.
Yeah, somewhere. Da, 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 da. And who's your favourite artist, singer, band who's got nothing to do with rap or hip hop? Tom.
Yeah, it's Tom Waits.
Tom Waits, of yes, course it is. Check out down in the hole. I think my favourite Don't Flop battle would be Murta versus Soliloquy.
Well, that's on King of the Ronalds, so that's embarrassing.
Well, obviously I've now just created even more beef between them two.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, this has been a really fun really. I have no interest in battle rap. I've just come here to plug my own stuff. I don't really have any loyalty to you as a friend, really. Mm-hmm. But this has been fantastic, really, and we're just a bang on approaching 2 hours.
Yeah, crazy.
So this has been Tom Kwei, this is your life.
Yeah.
Battle rap resume, we've done the host now. We've got the cringe factor out of the way. The top comment on the YouTube video is like, the cringe is too real, isn't
it? Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And yeah, it's been so funny just to see you go through that. And like, I don't think you failed, but I think you just saw that you could put your efforts into it. Yeah, you know, you realize your efforts were best spent elsewhere. And obviously you've got this titan of a show now where you get 2,000 views in less than a week. So mm-hmm. I'm your friend. I wish you the best of luck with the future of this show, and I'd like to come back for episode 212 if if that's okay.
Yeah, man, it would be good. I mean, I don't know what capacity we could really have you back, but even if, say, you know, King of the Dark Cage, you do live pay-per-views, and I've always wanted to kind of stay up late and just watch it and just get fucked and whatever, and maybe one day we'll watch it and you can give your sort of unseasoned views on on whoever and whatever, but
ill-educated, uninformed, uninterested views. Yes, that
so be- so yeah. At BRR resume, BRRResume@gmail.com. thank you everyone for listening. Episode 50, crazy. We're going to be keep going, you know. We'll see you at episode 51 and episode 100 and whatever else. But cheers as well. Sam, thank you so much, bro, for doing this.
See you episode on 212, mate.
Awesome. Easy.
Some time, been casing this joint for a while, and soon those balls will be mine. I scoped out the place, got my trackers all ready. Hitting download, the green grows, my palms getting sweaty. Soon as I get what I need, out in the way I'll be seeding. G's illegally downloaded PDFs I could be reading. Music industry's bleeding, and I don't care. I'm dealing strictly in those files that end dot rare.
Yo, cause I'll rob anything if it's online. Take whatever I need if it got that seed. Cause I'll rob anything if it's online. Cause I'm AVI, I'm always villainous, eh?
Cause fuck legal, I don't want that shit for free. I'm a G, never happy less it's digital larceny. I love that shit dirty like my files compressed. I'm zipping that shit, may as well be your mama's dress. Clans going ham like it's fucking lunchtime. Never HAPPY less it's virtual crime. I'm the digital dick dastardly, no file is getting past to me. No bandwidth is as fast as me at getting what you pay for free.
Cause I'll rob anything if it's online. Take whatever I need if it got that seed. Cause I'll rob anything if it's online. Cause I'm AVI, I'm always villainous, aye?
But let's get real for a minute. I'm sending this out to friends that fell to the dust and bit it. Those fallen soldiers that swallow music folders. My brother from another mother, mini nother. Respect to those still left in this game. The ones who made purchasing never the same. Cause I'm on ISO hunt till I'm a sore-eyed cunt. Forever sailing the seas of free MP3s.
Yo, have you heard that new Klandestine song?
Yeah, it's brilliant, man. I've already got it.
What, you bought it?
I'll buy it. You gotta be joking. I already torrented it.